Call this Caddo Parish Commission, April 7th, regular session meeting to order. Mr. Hopkins, if you'll do the roll call, please.
Dominic, Johnson, Jackson, Lynn, Bowman.
Present.
Cawthorn, Gage Watts, Middleton.
Here.
Atkins, Chavez, Smith.
Here.
Epperson.
Present.
Fantastic.
We have a quorum, Mr. President.
Thank you, sir. Commissioner Bowman, if you will say the invocation, and Commissioner Middleton, if you will do the Pledge of Allegiance, please. Everyone stand.
Heavenly Father, we come now with bowed heads and humble hearts, dear Master. Lord, we just thank you for this day. Lord, we ask for forgiveness of sins. Father God, I ask you just guide and touch each one of us, Lord, and everyone who's assembled here, Lord. Help us to remember our purpose, Lord. Help us to remember that we're here for the people. Help us, Lord, to be productive and progressive, and that even if we disagree, that we come back amicably, knowing that we're all for the same cause. Lord, these are the blessings I ask, and we thank in your Son Jesus' name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Everyone, please face the flag. Place your right hand over your heart. If you're a military veteran, please do a hand salute and repeat with me, or recite with me, the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any agenda additions? Commissioner Jackson.
Yeah, I was going to, I'm requesting that we add resolution number 30 of 2016 to the agenda.
That's a motion to expand the agenda, sir?
Yeah, motion to expand the agenda to add resolution number 30 of 2016.
Second. Motion was made by Commissioner Jackson and second by Commissioner Bowman to expand the agenda to consider resolution 30 of 2016. Everyone please vote. And that fails.
Now we need to move resolution 30. It fails.
Yep.
Mine.
That's it. It has to pass. Right. Okay. Commissioner Dominic.
Yeah, I would like to move resolution number 27 up to special resolution, if that's okay.
Motion is made by Commissioner Dominic to rearrange the agenda, second by Commissioner Jackson. Please vote. That passes. Item. Oh, excuse me, there's another agenda addition. Commissioner Jackson?
Yeah, I want to move the resolution related to crime victims.
Up to special resolution?
Yes.
I'll second that.
Point of order. Do you want that read today?
No.
Or you just, okay, then we could leave it under resolutions. Okay. And go forward from there.
You got someone here?
I withdraw that. Yes, she's here, but she can come under the administrative report then. I apologize. I withdraw that.
Okay.
Citizens' comments? Are we there? Oh, wait. Mr. Hawkins.
We're good.
Okay. Fantastic.
My bad, Todd. I got confused.
So we have a definite thing. Okay. Citizens' comments. All citizens have 3 minutes to address the commission on any issue that you would like. Please, if you have not and you would like to speak, fill out a card and hand it to Mr. Hopkins. The first person on the list is Mr. Kenneth Kreff.
Mr. President, Dr. Wilson, members of the commission, Kenneth Kreff at 157 Archer Avenue in Shreveport. 71105. Before I get to my main comments, I just want to give a little memoriam to a good friend, Tom Ploche, who passed away, who was a member of our association and worked at the polls. And get our age and you look in the paper and there's somebody you're near to. My request is for you guys to develop a means by which we as a commission can more effectively do proper background checks on potential nominees or appointees to various boards or commissions. Particularly 3 weeks ago on St. Patty's Day, there were some candidates to fill a vacancy on the MPC. Y'all subsequently moved and approved Reverend Theron Jackson, and that was fine until the next day I find out about ethics fines and such as that. And it would have been better, I guess, had we known that publicly or had it come up in the discussion. Your vote might have not changed at all, but I'd like to think some of you would have changed. And I don't know if this takes a resolution or if there's a subcommittee, Mr. President, of the commission who does background checks, but when I checked with the ethics board, and that was that same day I read that, and that's been 3 weeks tomorrow, so at that time, the lady in charge fine said that the fines still had not been paid. They may have been paid since. I hope so. But just keep that in mind and try to come up with some method by which this doesn't happen again. We want to move forward, and we don't want to be appointing people, I would think, who have had ethics fines unpaid for several years in this case. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Bobby Jokes.
Bobby Jelks, President Frank's Management Company, 1312 North Hearn Avenue, Shreveport, Louisiana. And I'm speaking in regard to resolution number 22, and wanted to give you some general information. I want to share with you the history of the I-20 Greenwood Road property. Frank's Investment Company bought this property in May 1979. We've had it for 37 years, so it's a long-term investment. And it's never been advertised for sale or listed for sale with a realtor. And I wanted you to know I'm happy to continue holding that property as a timber and land investment. And I'm not here to ask Caddo Parish for anything. The state of Louisiana came to me 6 years ago, and the Economic Development Department, and asked me to if they could review our land holdings and to see if there were some suitable sites for very large projects. They have plenty of sites for small projects, and so that's not the goal. The mission has been to bring jobs to Louisiana, jobs that put money in people's pockets and generate sales tax revenue. LED has approximately 130 employees focused entirely on this matter, trying to generate jobs for Louisiana. I'm convinced that those 130 employees are doing a very good job and know exactly what they're doing. They tell me that large quality sites are rare and hard to come by. The state involved regionally focused NLEP, whom you know, and together they identified this site, I-20 at Greenwood Road, and asked if I would be willing to invest time and money to meet their certification requirements. We signed a cooperative endeavor agreement and worked for 2 years to meet their requirements. Again, they're asking me to do this, okay? Working with NLEP, we've learned that attracting 1,000-plus employee job creators is very difficult and extremely competitive. Every state wants as many as they can get. We will be eliminated by some site selectors, but just simply because the consultants will eliminate our sites. Every opportunity is slightly different. One might want rail service, another might want to be as far away from rail service as possible. They don't want blocked railroad crossings or noise. And they have no interest in a retrofit situation. Motion for example.
Second.
You got three more minutes.
Okay.
That passed by acclamation.
Okay.
Sorry, thank you.
For example, CSRA in Bossier City, and Bentler Steel in Caddo Parish. Both of those would not use an existing site, I mean, existing building, new construction only. If we are able to land an opportunity, it will not be luck. In many cases, we are competing with Texas, Oklahoma, and Arkansas. In other situations, we're competing with every state in the country. The competition is focused, well-funded, and aggressive. Texas often wins, as they did with Amazon. If Caddo Parish wants a 1,000-plus job opportunity, what we need to do, we will all need to pull in the same direction and show that we want it. The state is on the team as the quarterback. They are happy as long as it's in Louisiana. NLEP is on the team, and they represent you. AEP is on the team because power, large amounts of power, is essential. The city's on the team because this tract is entirely within the city of Shreveport. And I'm on the team because I'm a cooperative landowner. I understand from the state of Louisiana, that's also rare. Again, I'm not here to ask for anything. I'm just recommending and suggesting that if you want a large employer, you need to send a message that you want, that Caddo Parish wants the opportunity, and you need to work within LEP to have as many qualified sites as you possibly can, including mine. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Scott Martinez.
Good afternoon. I'm Scott Martinez, president of the North Louisiana Economic Partnership. I live in Caddo Parish at 225 Wingfoot Drive. I'm here to speak in opposition of Resolution 22. I do economic development. I'm focused on capital investment and jobs and bringing them to Caddo Parish and the other areas that I serve. This is a very important site for development in Caddo Parish and the region. There's been lots of discussion about multiple sites being available in Caddo Parish, and that's true. But this one is unique from many aspects. First of all, it's close to Interstate 20. The other sites that have been referenced have distance to Interstate 20. If you're dealing with moving cargo, any sort of warehouse opportunities, manufacturing that requires a lot of employees, mobility is important, and getting the facility as close to that interchange as possible is very important. So this is unique in that regard. Look, this site has been studied since 1979, and lots of resources has been put into this, not only by Mr. Jelks and Frank's management, but also by AEP SWEPCO. This is through the PUD that MPC passed unanimously a few weeks ago. There have been protections that have been put in place as regard to barriers, sound, and what can actually be done with this type of zoning. You know, this isn't a zoning that really lends itself to smokestacks and noise and those type of operations. There's also been discussion about, you know, a distribution center won't look because of rail. Well, there's a lot of quality manufacturing companies that I've worked with over my 20-year career that don't want to be anywhere near a railroad, especially if they're dealing with very precise machinery and that sort of thing. They don't want to be close to that vibration from that railroad. So this site has lots of things going for it that simply want to conclude by just saying Caddo Parish needs jobs. In 2015, this parish lost almost 1,700 jobs due to mainly the energy sector decline. That's a global issue that NLEP and LED can't necessarily control, but we can control having properties available and going out and marketing the properties we have to employment generators in our area. This site is an employment generator. It's unique. And I encourage this commission, all of whom I consider friends, to look at this in a holistic way and sending the right messages to companies to say that Caddo Parish is open for business. And luck was mentioned earlier. Luck is what happens when preparation meets opportunity. Having a site like this is preparation. us going out and marketing this site gives us that opportunity to be competitive and win projects that enhance the lives of Caddo Parish residents. Thank you so much for your consideration and time.
Thank you. Mr. Ed Benix.
I'm Major Ed Benix with the Salvation Army over on 200 East Stoner Avenue. I'm just here to support the resolution for to get reimbursement on flood assistance for the 2015 Caddo floods. The Salvation Army expended over almost $7,000 in expenses. We're happy to do the work in this community. We love to do the work in this community. We fed a lot of responders, fed at the EOC, fed folks working out at the flood control areas, building the HESCO baskets and filling those and doing that work. And we worked sometimes around the clock. In addition to my fellow VOAD members that are here today, I just want to ask for your support in this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Martha Merrick.
Thank you, President Lynn, Commissioners. I'm Martha Merrick. My address is 2307 Texas Avenue, Shreveport, Louisiana. It's my pleasure to be here before you today, and thank you for this opportunity. I'm here today representing not just the Food Bank of Northwest Louisiana, but an organization called VOAD. And I believe you may have all received a sheet of paper. VOAD actually stands for Voluntary Organizations Active in Disaster. They have VOAD organizations on a national, state, and local level. And we are basically the organizations that work together. We meet throughout the year that are the first groups that are there to help our citizens when there is a disaster. Before FEMA comes, usually American Red Cross, Salvation Army, and the rest of the nonprofit community is there to aid help. In 2015, many of the nonprofits provided a lot of resources to our flood victims, primarily in the MLK area, and we had expenses that we would hope that you would help us with. These were expenses that we covered through our operating expenses so that we could provide this service. So we have come before you today. There are two more organizations that are going to make the same request to try and restore us with some funding that we use to provide some help and assistance, much needed first response assistance to our citizens of Caddo Parish. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Mr. David Tinkus.
Hi, I'm David Tinkus. I'm the CEO of Goodwill Industries of North Louisiana, 800 West 70th Street, Shreveport. We are a member of VOAD, and we are also in support of a resolution to provide reimbursement for the 2015 flood. We have been a longtime member of VOAD. Our organization, as well as the organizations listed, and actually there's many more, stand ready every time that there's a disaster. We've assisted in the flooding that occurred this year as well. As these incidences occur, of course, it impacts our organizations significantly, especially those of us that disaster relief is not our primary mission. We see value in it, of course, and we want to serve the community. But when these things occur, it does impact all of us, and we're hopeful that the parish would recognize that and assist us with reimbursement. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Michelle Davison.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is Michelle Davison. I'm the Executive Director for the American Red Cross, 805 Brook Hollow Drive in Shreveport. I am here with my fellow nonprofits to ask that you consider this reimbursement for the VOAD expenses from this spring floods. You know, it was actually kind of sad. I had to ask Martha which disaster this was for. because unfortunately right now we are on our third major disaster in less than a year. This is the mission of the Red Cross, but even the Red Cross doesn't have the funds to be able to respond at this level this frequently. These aren't built into our everyday operating funds. They are part of what we use for these major disasters. We either have to raise the money somewhere else, or we have to go out across the nation and try to raise those funds. So this is not money that any of us have built into our budgets. For organizations like Goodwill and even the food bank, this is outside of their normal operations. And so even the money that you may allocate through the Caddo Parish Commission may not be money that they can use for disaster relief, because they already have it allocated for other programs. For the Red Cross, of course, we don't currently receive any money from the Commission, and so that is a consideration that we would ask that you make. We have appreciated so much the support that you guys have given over this last year. I don't know if you guys understand how much of a rock you have been for Caddo Parish. What resources have been made available through this Commission have not been made available in other parishes. And for this particular disaster that we're in right now, this is statewide. 50% of the parishes in Louisiana are affected, 28 of the 29 in North Louisiana, and all of the 20 parishes in Northeast and Northwest are affected. And no other parish is making funds for their public, for their people available the way this commission does. So that level of generosity for the people that are affected by this flood is unprecedented, and I would ask that you also consider, not just for Red Cross, but for all of these organizations who do such a fantastic job and are there so quickly when the need arises, that you would help to kind of help reimburse them and make them whole, as this disaster has shown the need for. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Michelle. Thank you very much. That is all of the request that I have.
Next we move to visitors. Mrs. Zell Dudley, NLP. I think she's unavailable at this time.
Chairman, could I get a point of information before we move?
Thank you. Yes. Commissioner Epperson.
Okay, request about the volunteer organizations. That's on the agenda.
I believe on our agenda we have the final funding for flood relief that is carryover of the several hundred thousand dollars that we put in place in 2015 for the flood that has left the residual.
Reimbursing these agencies. Is there anything on the agenda?
I didn't see anything.
Yeah.
There, the money that is for the flood victims that they took care of is on the agenda.
Right, I understand that, but I was wondering,
I guess one of us could make it an amendment to that to make them whole.
No, I was just wondering with that, you know, I was sort of confused.
Okay.
Because it's not a resolution that's on there. It's should be an ordinance.
It should be an introduction, isn't it?
Yeah.
So we're not, I mean, this might even be put in.
Well, we
pardon
got
me,
it.
Pardon me. Mr. Hopkins?
What we have on our agenda today, we have an emergency ordinance that has a public hearing and passage today. The emergency for the 2016 flood.
Right.
Which ordinance is that?
That is number 5573.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But I just want to make it clear, right, it's not in here to reimburse these organizations. Right.
That's what I'm saying. Right.
Yeah, that's
right.
What I'm saying.
Thank you. Next item, Mr. Hopkins.
Okay, next we move to special resolutions. First, we have a resolution recognizing Megan and Shane Rogers, Chad Morvan, of Shane Seafood for their volunteer involvement feeding first responders during the 2016 Caddo Parish flood.
I second Commissioner Chavez's motion.
Thank you, Doug.
If you would stand with me in reading of the proclamation. By the authority of the Caddo Parish Commission, resolution of recognition and commendation to Shane Seafood and Barbecue. Whereas the Caddo Parish Commission desires to give appropriate recognition to those men and women of Caddo Parish who serve the community and who, in doing so, reflect favorably and positively upon themselves, their families, and all the citizens of the parish. And whereas Shane Seafood and Barbecue owners and staff moved quickly during the 2016 Caddo Parish flooding disaster to not only support citizens, but also the volunteers helping to assist the flood victims. And whereas Shane's staff diligently attempted to not only provide meals for victims of the flood by providing 200 plus meals of ribs, brisket, and sides through the American Red Cross and Salvation Army, they also fed 85 deputies and volunteers at the Sheriff's substation on Mansfield Road. And whereas Megan and Shane Rogers truly believed in the golden rule in God's word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, as they worked to help their community during the 2016 flood. Now therefore be it resolved by the Caddo Parish Commission in legal and regular session convened the 7th day of April 2016, that it does hereby extend its heartiest expressions of appreciation and commendation to Shane's Seafood and Barbecue, and most notably to owners Megan and Shane Rogers, along with region manager Chad Morvan, for the dedication they displayed in assisting the citizens and volunteers. Signed, Matthew Lynn, President, Mario Chavez, District 10.
That passed by acclamation. Next item.
At this
please.
Time, we have a proclamation of recognition proclaiming Osteogenesis and Perfecto Awareness Day.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Dominic, seconded by Commissioner Jackson, passes by acclamation.
Would you please stand for the reading, please? By the authority of the Caddo Parish Commission, proclaiming Osteogenesis Imperfecta Awareness Day. Whereas Osteogenesis Imperfecta, OI, also known as brittle bone disease, is a genetic disorder that causes a person's bones to break easily, often from little or no apparent trauma. And whereas it is estimated that approximately 25,000 to 50,000 people in the U.S. have OI. And whereas OI is a complicated, variable, and a rare disorder caused by genetic defects that disturb the body's ability to make strong bones. And whereas OI is a lifelong disorder and occurs equally among males and females in all racial groups. And whereas OI exhibits a wide variation of appearance and severity being described as mild, moderate, or severe, the most severe forms lead to early death. Clinical features such as fracture frequency, muscle strength, or extraskeletal problems vary widely between types. And whereas research, education, and community support services are needed to raise awareness about this little-known disease and to find more effective treatments and quality to those living with OI, now there be it resolved by the Caddo Parish Commission, meeting in legal and regular session the 7th day of April 2016, it does proclaim today as Osteogenesis and Perfecto Awareness Day. And Caddo Parish, Louisiana urges all citizens to join with the parish in recognition of this important day. Signed, Matthew Lynn, President, Doug Dominic, District 1.
Y'all will just indulge me for a minute. This is my daughter. She's here.
Y'all will have to get a picture. You can hand it to one of us.
This is a touchy.
But I know she takes after my wife, so nobody even has to make the comment. Girls.
Hello, my name is is Lance Celeste Dominic. I am the reigning 2016 Miss Preteen Louisiana Redbud. I will be competing in Teen Princess Louisiana pageant in June. My platform is OI, osteogenesis imperfecta, or brittle bone disease. This is a rare disease that most people know very little about. It is my hope and intent to bring awareness to this disease as well as raise money for families in Louisiana that are in need of getting help with their children who have OI. Osteogenesis imperfecta is a complicated and rare disorder. OI is caused by a mutation in a gene that affects bone formation, bone strength, and the structure of other tissues. It is a lifelong disorder. OI occurs equally among males, females, and in all racial groups. It is estimated that approximately 25,000 to 50,000 people in the U.S. have OI. There are several families in Louisiana that this disease affects. This is a cause that is near and dear to my heart. We have a special baby in our family named Layton. He was born with OI. As a result, he had broken bones before he was even born. He continues to break bones frequently just by trying to roll over, crawl, or pull up. Even with all his struggles, he is such a happy baby. Babies and children with OI deserve to have the best quality of life possible. Many other diseases have lots of funding and help because they are well known. OI is not as well known as funding and help because they are well known. OI is not as well known, and therefore, there is not as much research or funds available for this disease. Please help me to raise awareness to this disease. If we can bring awareness to OI, one day there will be more research and hopefully a cure. Thank you.
Don't sit down. Raising money for this, so I appreciate y'all taking the time to pass this resolution. Thank you so much.
Wait a minute, don't go. Miss Dominique. We know where you got your good looks from, Mom. I know, but you know I got to get you. One of our long protracted meetings, Doug and I were talking about getting a haircut. I make an appointment for my haircut, and I have to pay for it whether I make the appointment or not. So you did a good thing, baby. I see Doug got a haircut.
This time we'll move to adopt the minutes of the regular session for March 17th.
So moved. Second. Motion is made by Commissioner Middleton and seconded by Commissioner Jackson to accept the minutes from March 17th. Everybody please vote. That passes.
Next we move to communiques and committee reports, administration response to information requests.
President, good afternoon, commissioners. We have a couple of items today. I have a commissioner's request, and I'd like to have Ms. Vicki Johnson come forward and give you a brief report on the special victims report.
Good afternoon, Dr. Wilson, commissioner board meetings members. My name is Deputy Vicki Johnson, and I'm employed with the Caddo Parish Sheriff's Office. I'm the coordinator for our crime victims program. Crime Victims Reparation is a program that's generally funded through fines and fees imposed down through criminal court sentences, private donations. It's also a program that assists victims of crime in paying things such as medical expenses, lost wages, loss of support, child care, and in worst case scenarios, it also assists with paying funeral and burial expenses. For the past 30 years, the Office of Violent Crimes, or the Office for Victims of Crime, OVC, we host what's called National Crime Victims Rights Week. And this year, April the 10th through 16th, has been dedicated as National Crime Victims Rights Week. And what that does is it provides an opportunity for us to promote awareness and to just show how far we've come and the steps that we've made in victims' rights and the services that's provided to them. This year, on April the 11th, we'll be hosting a proclamation ceremony to kick the week off. It'll be held at the Federal Courthouse at 300 Bannon Avenue, Bannon Street, here in Shreveport. And on April the 14th, we'll have a service award, which will the Caddo Parish Sheriff's Office will be recognizing some outstanding agencies that actually work on a day-to-day basis with victims of crime. There are some outstanding organizations, and we work really hard with victims of crime. So I just wanted to let you know that we do have that service available. A lot of people are unaware of it. So National Crime Victim Rights Week does give us an opportunity to promote that service. Thank you.
Commissioner Jackson.
Are we not walking this year? We usually do a walk. There's no
yes,
walk
we there. Usually walk this walk, but we're not walking this year. We're going to have a service award to recognize the outstanding agencies for working with the victims.
And I just was going to say, I've been a part of the program, and in years past, Ms. Tavia Seals' mother has been part of it, and Ms. Johnson does a great job from the Sheriff's Office working with the program, getting these resources to individuals. And so if you know of individuals in your districts, in your areas, parish-wide, that need her assistance, she's more than willing and capable and ready. A lot of people don't know about those resources. And so appreciate you for all that you do for Caddo Parish, and look forward to participating in the ceremony next Thursday.
Thank you. And if you do know anybody, just have them to contact me, Deputy Johnson, over at the Caddo Parish Sheriff's Office.
Commissioner.
Johnson.
Thank you. Commissioner Middleton.
I just want to brag. I worked with Ms. Johnson for many years, and she's always done a great job at the Sheriff's Office, and I know this program is being handled with her heart and her mind. So thank you for what you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That is everybody.
Thank you. Okay. Commissioners, you should have at your desk the quarterly financial report for this first quarter. If you have any questions, please ask myself and Ms. Erica Bryan. We'd be glad to entertain it for you. That concludes my report.
Thank you. Commissioner Johnson?
Well, I'm waiting for Dr. Wilson to get finished with this stuff. Finished?
Yes, sir, I am.
Okay. I'm going to communicate.
Okay. Oh, we're okay. You're finished. Okay. Does anybody have any questions for Administrator Wilson? Then we'll just go straight to Commissioner Johnson. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. I emailed the commissioners that were on the last term for the evaluations of Dr. Wilson and Todd, and I need those evaluations back so that we can have a meeting. I want to try to schedule the meeting at our next work session so that we can move forward with the evaluation of 2015. And the reason why is because Commissioner Baker was the chairperson, and I thought she had finished that, but she didn't. So this is something that was still left over from 2015 that we need to address. And so I need your guys' input so that we can have the meeting and get that done and finish out 2015. Next thing is, I saw in the news where they had a child abuse program at the detention center. And I didn't see any correspondence inviting us or letting us know about it. And I overlooked it, but I don't think I did. So,
child abuse program?
Huh?
The child abuse program?
Right, right. I saw, some city officials there, but I didn't see nobody from the parish. So I wanted to make sure that we were invited, and if we wasn't invited, there's a gap in that process. You know, we were here to invite one local government, but not the other one. So. And then it's at our building. It makes it even worse.
I don't know.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. I was not invited either.
Neither was I, for the record.
All right. Commissioner Epperson.
He was back there.
I'd like to thank Facilities and Maintenance for little gift bags. I addressed the Southern Hills Healthcare Center and the seniors that were residents there. They were highly appreciative of the gift bags. Kevin, we thank you for that. and they said to tell all of you commissioners that they watch television, they watch us on television, and they vote. They get the mail-in ballots, and the ones that can still, that's still ambulatory, they get out and they go and vote. And Dr. Wilson, one gentleman stated that he followed you for a long time. He knew you in the Air Force. And so they say they watch us, and they thank you all for those bags. Also, I'd like to thank the Public Works Department for the cooperation with the Timberline and Deer Creek annual spring cleanup on April the 1st through the 2nd. We appreciate you bringing those trash bins out. Also, special thanks to State Representative Barbara Norton, State Representative Sam Jenkins, and Senator John Milkovich during our legislative visit on March the 31st to the Capitol in Baton Rouge. They were most gracious hosts. When you get with Ms. Norton, you're going to go wherever she wants you to go.
That's true.
They introduced us to everybody, took us to all the departments, made us feel quite welcome. We always appreciate that, as well as Sam Jenkins, who's newly elected, and Senator John Milkovich. Those are the ones that I caught up with. We were also graciously hosted by our Colonel Joey Strickland, the new Louisiana Department of Veterans Affairs Secretary, Lieutenant Governor Billy Nungesser, and a number of other department heads at the state capitol. We received graciously. Dr. Wilson, I think we sort of let it slip through the cracks. Sussler's aerospace program was to come and give us a report as to how they are going to coordinate with the Caddo Parish school system.
So we made a request to have them come before you. Mm-hmm. Next work session meeting.
Yeah. Next work session? Yes, sir. Okay.
I did talk.
All right. The Veteran Celebration Committee will meet on April the 29th at 11 a.m. in the large conference room in the plaza here in the commission's office. We will be appointing committee members, so anyone that would like to help participate with this year's 2016 Veterans Parade and Honor Ceremony, which will be held Sunday, November 13th, 2 o'clock p.m. at the Louisiana State Fairgrounds. It's basically a certainty that Governor John Bel Edwards would be our Grand Marshal this year. You're welcome to come and participate. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Middleton.
Most immediately and directly, Animal Services Committee. We're going to meet April the 18th, which is right before work session, at 2 o'clock p.m. So those people, Mr. Clark, you'll notify the people on the committee, I'm sure. Thank you. And then the other things tomorrow, just a reminder for everyone, Leaders Against Litter, tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. at the State Exhibit Museum on Fairgrounds. And then also Saturday is Great American Cleanup for everybody to get out there and pick up a gum wrapper or something. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Middleton. Commissioner Jackson.
Yes, appreciate it, Mr. President. I'll piggyback real quickly. Just want to emphasize, appreciate you for mentioning the Great American Cleanup. I have it on my notes. Also want to emphasize that hope that all citizens will exercise their civic duty and go out and vote this Saturday. Won't tell you how to vote, won't tell you how I voted, but I have early voted. Hope that you get out and exercise your right to vote. We have some important issues on the ballot, and hope that you will exercise that right. Also want to make it known, because I represent this particular area in downtown, that there's a lot going on in between now and the next time we meet. Hope for the homeless will be having their crawfish with clergy. That is a fundraiser that Hope Connection puts on annually to support their efforts to combat homelessness throughout North Louisiana. It's not just a Shreveport deal. They are a regional organization that's doing a great job with combating homelessness as well as veteran homelessness as well. The Makers Fair, or just the big scene, we had a very good discussion earlier about what's going on and what we want to see our downtown be. I'm a believer, if you don't ever get out and experience these things, if you don't ever get out to see what's going on in downtown, you never really know what is going on. And I have a lot of folks say, well, there's nothing to do here on the weekend. But the big scene is next Saturday, April 16th. It's an opportunity for the arts community. You have a lot of music out. You have street art. Last time we had a big scene, that was a big mural that was painted on Texas Street. You also will have the Makers Fair going on at that time. So it's a lot of, it's an opportunity for us to support local artists, local entrepreneurs at the Texas Avenue Makers Fair. So get out and support them. And then there's also a dish crawl going on. It'll take place on, I want to say, April 19th. That'll be on Louisiana Avenue. And so if you get a chance, that's supporting the name doesn't come to me, but they're doing a project, the Norla Project. They're looking at rehabbing some houses on the west edge with shotgun houses, doing some things kind of like how you see in New Orleans with regards to jazz and those kind of things. And so there's a lot going on in Shreveport, Caddo, a lot going on in downtown, and hope that individuals will take the opportunity to experience them. Hopefully you will have a greater appreciation for them. I was having a conversation just yesterday, and somebody raised a very great point, is that if Shreveport, Caddo, and this region is going to grow, I think, Scott, you would probably agree, most of that growth is going to have to come from within Shreveport and Caddo. We cannot always depend on folks from the outside coming in to make that growth happen. So we're going to have to, we talked about identity earlier, we're going to have to develop that identity. We're going to have to develop that culture here. When we go to New Orleans, we know what we're going to look for. When you go to Austin, you know what you're going to look for. When you go to Atlanta, you know what you're going to look for. And so the Makers Fair, the big scene, everything that's going on, all the vibrancy that's going on in downtown, all plays into that. And so hopefully everybody, commissioners and the public, for those watching, you get out, experience those things, and see what Shreveport, Caddo has to offer. So I appreciate it, Mr. President.
Thank you. That is everybody on the board.
Next, we move to the President's report.
It's great that we have a large audience today. One of the things that the parish does in working with the city of Shreveport and working with Homeland Security is that when there is an issue like what we had in 2015 when the Red River rose and flooded so many homes, and the issue that we had in 2016 just about a month ago when it rained so hard that engineering could not have been prepared for the downfall and the stormwater runoff that we had and houses flooded then, in both scenarios the parish has asked for help. They've asked for help from anybody that can give help. The main agency that gives us help is Northwest Louisiana VOAD, which is several nonprofit organizations that come together. Now, what these nonprofit organizations did without asking if they could afford to do it, without, you know, coming back to the commission to say, if you give us this money, we'll be able to do this, they immediately ran down their operating cost and gathered blankets and gathered food. They met at Southern University. They met at other locations throughout Caddo Parish, and they kept Caddo Parish citizens whole. Now, in the process of keeping Caddo Parish citizens whole, they ran down their operating cost. And so I just want all of us to be very well aware that when we went back, when in 2015, when we went to these groups and asked them for help, we didn't anticipate possibly coming back in 2016 and having to ask them for help. And I pray to God that in 2017, we don't have to come back and ask these agencies for help. But I hope that if we do have to come back in this year or next year and ask them to feed the hungry, to provide shelter for people, and to provide instantaneous blankets for people, that they have the financial resources in order to be able to provide for the Caddo Parish citizens, as we have in the past set money aside for that to happen. That is the end of my President's report. Thank you.
Next, we move to public hearing on ordinances. Ordinance number 5566 of 2016, authorizing the sale of not exceeding $7,500,000 of general obligation refunding bonds. Provide the sale of said bonds provides minimum net present value savings after payment of all costs in excess of minimum present value Savings to Refund Guidelines of the State Bond Commission. Now, this is a public hearing.
Okay. Is there anybody here to speak in favor of Ordinance 5566 of 2016? Is there anybody here to speak in opposition of Ordinance 5566 of 2016? Next item, please.
I'll close the public hearing on 5566. We move to 5567, declaring certain adjudicated, declaring Parish's intention to acquire full ownership of certain adjudicated properties for economic development.
Is there anybody here to speak in favor of Ordinance 5567 of 2016? Is there anybody here to speak in opposition of Ordinance 5567 of 2016? I see no. Next item, please.
That closes 5567. Move to 5568. Amending the budget of estimate revenues and expenditures for Capital Outlay Fund and the Public Works Fund for the year 2016 to correct the 2016 budget to include an appropriation of $1.250 million for the Dawson Road project.
Is there anybody here to speak in favor of Ordinance 5568 of 2016? Is there anyone here to speak in opposition of Ordinance 5568 of 2016? I see no one. Next item.
Move to 5573, an emergency ordinance authorizing emergency aid to those who were affected by the 2015 flood, December 27, 2015 tornado, and the March 2016 flood.
Is there anybody here to speak in favor of Ordinance 5573 of 2016? Is there anyone here to speak in opposition of Ordinance 5573 of 2016? Next item, please.
Next, that closes all public hearings on ordinances. We move to ordinances for final passage. Ordinance number 5566 of 2016, authorizing sale of not exceeding $7,500,000 of general obligation bonds.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Johnson and second by Commissioner Middleton. Would you like to speak on your motion, anybody? I'd like to speak on this. I stood on my soapbox when this was introduced. I'm going to take this opportunity to stand on it one more time. I've served on the commission body 9 years. Every single year that I have served on the commission body, this body as a whole, we as a whole, have reduced taxes. Because of our AAA bond rating, when something comes up, we are able to renegotiate that loan that we have on behalf of the citizens for a lower interest rate. We then, in turn, give that money back to the citizens with a lower tax assessment on your property tax at the end of the year. So this year's taxes, your taxes for 2017, will be less than what they were this year. This year was less than they were in 2015. 2015 was less than 2014, and so on, all the way back to 2008. And I just want everybody to know that the Caddo Parish Commission does do good work and is fiscally very responsible to the citizens of Caddo Parish. Let's vote, please. Oh, excuse me, Commissioner Adkins.
Thank you, President Lynn. I just wanted to point out that when I saw this item on the agenda several weeks ago, after reviewing the issue, I called a bond salesman I know, a very well-respected bond salesman, and asked his opinion of our bond counsel listed here. And he's usually pretty skeptical, but he said that our current bond counsel, is a credit to you guys, is the best in the business. No doubts at all about the integrity of this of our bond counsel. So that gave me a better feel about this issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to y'all for.
I see no one on the board. Let's vote. And of course, that passes. Next item, please.
Ordinance number 5567, declaring the parish's intention to acquire full ownership of certain adjudicated properties.
I'm going to move to remand this to the Economic Development Committee.
Moved by Commissioner Jackson.
Second.
Second by the chair.
57.
Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. Second by Commissioner Atkins. Would you like to speak on your motion?
Yeah, I'm just going to. We're meeting tomorrow. We're meeting tomorrow. Not necessarily me, but we're going to get together. I'm pulling this for right now to give us an opportunity to. We want to create a real master plan for this area as opposed to focusing on these little smaller lots. We feel that it's a great project going on over there. We want to support that project, And so in the interest of doing the best thing and maximizing the opportunity over there, I'd like to send this to the Economic Development Committee. And again, we'll put our heads together. We've already been talking with the administration, some other commissioners. You're more than welcome to come be in on the discussion as well. And so this is not something that I want to move as fast. I think we've accomplished the point. I appreciate Robert. I appreciate your staff, Dr. Wilson. I appreciate you, Randy, Erica, for being available. Jimmy, I don't see him, but he's here as well. And like I said, we're just trying to make sure that we maximize the potential here. Willis Knighton is excited about what's going on over there. The city has some projects that they're working on. So I think this is an opportunity to get everybody on one page, one footing, to maximize the master plan. And I don't think anybody envisioned that Willis Knighton was going to buy Doctors Hospital in 2000. When did they adopt? When did they do the master plan? 10? Somewhere around there. Nobody envisioned that Willis Knighton was going to buy Doctors Hospital. But the master plan specifically says that we should develop areas using existing companies or projects such as Willis Knighton as the catalyst site for it. And that specifically, verbatim, is in the master plan. I may be paraphrasing there for a little bit, but that is in there. Nobody envisioned that Willis Knighton would be doing this expansion in the Highland area or downtown Shreveport area. If you also look at Red River Brewing, that's developing in that area. It's a beautiful facility. I had a chance to go over there Friday, non-alcoholic, but I had an awesome time over there. The feel is great. It looks clean. And so this is going to be an opportunity, I think, to benefit the entire region if we do it right. So with that, I'd ask that we remand it to the committee.
Thank you. Commissioner Atkins, did you want to speak on your second?
Okay.
Commissioner Johnson?
I was just trying to get some point of clarification. You mentioned tomorrow you got a meeting.
Right. No, there's going to be a discussion, conversation with Willis Knighton, and they're, you know, they, we want to make sure that they're on board with what we're trying to do as well.
Okay. I thought you were basically saying that the Economic Development Committee was meeting.
No.
Which I was trying to make sure that you get that right, that we couldn't do that.
Absolutely. No economic development.
Point of information.
Thank you for the clarification. There is no economic development meeting tomorrow.
Thank you. Everybody, please vote.
And this is the Senate to committee.
Yes. Yeah. That passes. Next item, please.
Ordinance number 5568, amending the budget estimate revenues and expenditures for capital outlay and the Public Works Fund for year 2016, correct budget appropriation of $1.250 million for Dawson Road project.
So move.
Moved by Commissioner Epperson, second by Commissioner Johnson.
Would you like to speak on your motion?
Yes, sir. This $1.25 million was put in the budget. I think the should have been in the 2014 budget, if memory serves me correct. Much deliberation. Matter of fact, we locked up 6-6 on passing the entire budget for the upcoming year based upon that expenditure. However, there was an error that stated that they forgot to put it in the budget for that year, so the budget was adopted without that $1.25 million in there. The purpose of that was to look at the drainage situation, which has really manifested itself 2 years in a row. Just recently, the 2016 flooding, whereas it extended all the way up to Jolly Napier, and it was even worse than it had been previously. I don't know, many of you that may have seen the videos that were taken, the magnitude of the waters coming in both on the west side of Dawson Road as well as the east side of Dawson Road. There are some drainage just coming there, and the house that's located on the very corner of Dawson Road and Jefferson Page Road was basically up to the doors and above, I think, a 4 or 5 foot fence and both bridges was completely encompassed underwater, and our Public Works Department had to shut that road down. So those persons were basically locked in. No one could really get out or get in unless they had special vehicles. Or if there was a dire emergency, possibly, I guess they'd have to get a helicopter or some high wheel type military vehicle to get in to get those individuals out. Out of the 21 years that I've been here, first time to my knowledge that an expenditure of that magnitude had been forgotten out of the budget. Now, I'm not saying $1.25. I'm not saying $1,250. I'm saying $1.25 million that had a lot of deliberation, that basically locked the budget up 6-6.
Yes.
And it stated that that was forgotten. Some of you may be in business. My business experience, I had a CPA that made a mistake that cost me $6,000 in extra federal income taxes. And you can imagine what I had with that CPA. I also had an attorney that I had engaged that cost me some money significantly. And you can imagine what I did with that attorney. This is needed. It should have been in that capital outlay budget. It should not have been forgotten. I don't know how that could have been, that mistake could have been made. We need that now. I think during the flooding, I asked Mr. Wilson, did we get any drone photos of that area? Mr. Wilson, did we get any? Because that was hellacious up there. And for those of you that hadn't seen it, I'll download the flash drive and send it to you. We need to really address that problem. And what's going to possibly further manifest it in the event of this situation that C6-16 that they're working on Greenwood Road. Can you imagine clearing 300-something acres, putting a big concrete slab, 1.4 million square foot facility up there? You know where all that water gravitates from Greenwood Road? It goes north, down toward Jefferson Page in that area. It's going to further exacerbate that situation. So I ask that you would do the right thing, correct this error, put that $1.25 million back in, that the Public Works Department will make a concerted effort to address that drainage situation within that area, and hopefully it can relieve flooding of that magnitude and the inconvenience that has been caused to those citizens in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Commissioner Johnson, did you want to speak on your second?
That's it.
Commissioner Dominic.
Mr. Glass, Robert Glass, can you come up?
It's like deja vu.
Wake up. I got some questions. If you could briefly give us an update on this project. I know it's been going on for quite some time. Can you tell us, because we have some new commissioners on board, can you give us a history out there and kind of what's going on with this project, this road?
Well, the current project is to extend Dawson Road about 3,000 feet to a dead end. That's the project that y'all be discussing later on in the meeting. The original project was to extend Dawson Road south to Highway 80 to Greenwood Road through Rice Road. And you know, I gave everybody, I think everybody got a one-piece sheet with a couple of maps on there that has a short history of it. I mean, I can go over that if you want me to, but I gave everybody a copy of that.
What did can you tell us about the, you know, we initially put $1.25 million in there. How much money has been spent out of that $1.25 million, and what has it been spent on?
We spent, I think, about approximately $40,000 on the two studies that we've done for both projects. So we still got about $200,000.
Do what now?
We still got about $1,200,000.
What about the drainage issue? What has been done out there?
We've done some drainage on both sides of Jefferson Page Road. The major thing we fixed, there was a timber company that went in there and plugged up the pipes underneath Jolly Napier. We cleaned those out. We think those, you know, and we're not looking at the past rain we had, 10 or 12 inch rain. There's nothing we could do for anywhere for a rain like that. But we do think the repairs that we've done already for a 3 or 4 inch rain in a day, which would still be a big rain, we think that that will not go under anymore.
So whatever.
On the 10 inch rain, it did go under again, but it was only under for about 10 or 11 hours, which was far better than it used to do even with a 3 or 4 inch rain. So we do think that, you know, we're going to wait for a good rain, but nothing like the one we just had. So we think that the drainage issue out there for Dawson Road would be fixed. We don't think that it will go under again. If it does, we can, I want to say also, Ken Ward was out there when it was going under, and the water on both sides of the road was level. Even if we had put another pipe underneath the road, it's not going to flow. The water was so high, there was just no place for the water to go no matter what. So we think that the fix will be done if it's, you know, we just got to get a regular 3 or 4 inch rain and then we can see.
What would this, if we put this 1.25 million back in there, what would that be used for? Do we know?
Well, we wouldn't need it to do the extension, which is the discussion at the end of the meeting. We've got the money to do that project. We estimated it about 1.2 million. We've got more than that right now.
And can you tell me about when the residents initially came in here, I remember there were some issues about emergency vehicles getting down there. I guess the fire district, the ambulance.
Fire district.
What happened there?
The fire district's put in a new station on Jolly Napier, so it's just down the road from Dawson Road now. So that's really not an issue now.
All right. I don't have any other questions. I would just simply say that, you know, this has been going on for quite some time. I know that, if I remember correctly, a month or two ago, that we requested that the Dawson Road project go back to the committee. I don't think the committee's met. I don't think they made any recommendations. I know that Commissioner Epperson is proposing to put another $1.25 million in there, but I think that's kind of putting the cart before the horse. I don't think it's needed at this time. I know that, I guess we'll talk about it later, but it's just to extend the road to a dead-end street, just straight out. We have money to do that if that's what we wanted to do, which I don't think needs to be done. I think that as far as the drainage goes, that Mr. Glass is telling us that they've done some work out there. They fixed the drainage the best they can. If you're going to have the high flooding, 10, 12 inches rain in such a short period, anywhere it's going to flood. I know I had 12 or 14 roads in Caddo Parish District 1 that were closed for several days during the flooding. I know that there was a lot closed in Commissioner Jim Smith's district. When you have the flooding that we had, you're going to have issues on roads no matter what. There's not a whole lot we can do. So I'm not for putting the money back in there. So. That's where I'm at. I hope everybody supports voting no on this.
Thank you, Commissioner Dominic. Commissioner Bowman.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I just wanted to add, again, I'm not, for me, I think this is an old battle that we've been battling. I don't think it's even fair for even the new commissioners to have to contend with it. I agree, maybe the 1.2 may not be totally used for that, but for me, I just want a point of information. This whole deal is not, even with the survey, it wasn't contingent upon the survey being coming back. For me, it was the principle, and the principle that we held up last year's budget. Nothing capital outlay and anything, you correct me if I'm wrong, administration, contingent upon this being included, and we had the vote for it being included. Now, whether the amount needs to be reduced or something, that's different, but the whole principle is this was supposed to be, it was left out, and I still can't understand why, of all things, something of that magnitude, which did hold up an entire parish's budget, was not included, and certain pages were missing, because I even researched and discovered that, as you all remember. And so for me, it's really about the principle of, are we going to not do what we say we're going to do? I mean, I know we can go back and fine-tune, but this was supposed to just been in there. This shouldn't even be up for now. It should have been done for when we originally advocated for. Y'all can correct me if I'm wrong. Anyone?
Is there anything else?
No, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner Bowman. I will call on myself. I make a motion to return the $1.25 million to the general fund. If I could have a second, I'd like to speak on it.
Second.
Second made by Commissioner Middleton. So there is a motion made, substitute motion made by the chair and second by Commissioner Middleton. And I'd like to speak on this motion. And then if you'll clear the board and we'll start over. It has been stated in this meeting today that this money is needed for the project. It has also been clearly given to us by engineering that what is proposed, which is a several hundred foot cul-de-sac through private property, could be done for less than the money that is already in the bank. And so if I've got money in my checking account to go buy a fancy new car that I might not need, I don't need to double down and stick twice as much money in my checking account to go buy that. The money is there should we decide to make this expenditure, which is further down the road. So there is absolutely no need to put $1.25 million into this project when the project is clearly defined and we have all seen it, which is the cul-de-sac on private property, so that we've already got the money to do that. We've done two studies. We've done one study for the drive from Jefferson Page to Highway 80, and the cost benefit was not there. We've also done a second study out of the original $1.25 million that was allocated for the cul-de-sac on the private property. Now, there's still plenty of money to fulfill this project should we as a body decide to fulfill this project. There is absolutely no reason at all for this money to sit in limbo when there's absolutely no expenditure dreamt of by any of us to spend this money on. So because we have an expenditure, a possible expenditure of less than 1.25 or 1.2 million, and we already have 1.2 million allocated should we decide to do that project, there is absolutely no reason to double down on that and put $2.5 million into a budget for a proposed project that costs less than $1.2 million should we decide to do it. So all I ask is that we take this money that's on in front of us today that we get to vote on next and give it back to the division where it's supposed to be, which is our general fund. And so I just propose that we put this money from here back to the general fund. Commissioner Middleton, if you'd like to speak on the second.
No, I don't need to speak. You said it.
Commissioner Johnson.
Okay, you got me totally confused because if you vote against it, it stays where it's at.
Right.
You're making a motion to take some money and put it in from capital outlay fund and put it into the general fund. That's not what we're here to even discuss about. I mean, if we vote against it or you vote against it, then it stays in capital outlay, and that's where it should be at. It shouldn't take money from capital outlay and move it over to general fund. So basically, if you're against it, you vote no.
Vote against.
And if you vote for it, then it moves over and it goes that way. But otherwise, it's no need to make your motion because it's a yes or no. If you say no, then it doesn't go with it go to the Dawson Road project.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. Is that everything?
Yes.
Commissioner Epperson.
That has me confused too. Okay. I say your motion is moot.
All right. Well,
if you want for the original ordinance that's on the table, then you vote against it, and the money stays where it is. But anyway, you know, I've heard us. So, do you want to withdraw that?
No,
because it's not there.
No. It's you mute. Can speak on that. Okay, are you
okay.
finished?
Well, anyway, my reason for that $1.25 million is we need to make a comprehensive study upon the drainage within that area. If we are going to try to do anything, some of those people, the Dawsons, have lived over there since the, has owned property since the 1860s. People have suffered throughout all that time with this. And I've heard some commissioners say, well, they shouldn't have bought over there. Well, where could African Americans buy property prior to 1952? You couldn't buy property anywhere. You had to buy it where you could get it. And we often know a lot of times where that property ended up. And we say you're only blocked in for 10 or 11 hours. They on the newscast, if you drive, only 6 inches of water can cause a vehicle to float. They tell you every time, don't try to go through that. Does someone have to die? Well, some more people have to die. There has been a heart attack victim within that area. And the mother came down when we was deliberating this earlier and testified to that effect. Does someone have to die when we clearly have the money? People have been living over there and since the 1800s, doing the best they could with what they had, have made tremendous sacrifices. They may not be the wealthiest folks in the world paying the highest taxes, but when you put an accumulation of those people living there, they deserve that. We have over $19 million in the road fund budget. No reason for it. And I've been down here long enough when we didn't have any money to say, well, Commissioner, it sure sounds worthy, but we just don't have the money. Now we have the money. What's the reason for not wanting to give these people moral relief? Plain and simple. Now every time something come up for economic development, some big investor, it's all right, vote yes for that, enhance their property values. Well, who's gonna speak for the little man and woman? That's why they elected us. It's the moral and the right thing to do. That $1.25 million should be put in the capital outlay budget. It generally stays there for 3 years. We should look at a comprehensive study of the drainage situation over in that area. A sincere effort instead of these band-aid solutions. Every time we come up with a problem or get a heavy rain, then here we talk about what we're going to do. Holding those bridges out is not going to work. You should have seen that water coming down there. It is frightening. Mr. Hankins had to close that road. We have the money. Why don't we want to help these people? Good stewards in this community all their lives. So I appreciate you voting for the original motion.
Commissioner Chavez.
I actually want to speak on the original motion,
wait, we're still on the
right,
second.
Not on the motion.
You pass? Okay. Commissioner Cawthorn.
I want to speak on the original ordinance.
Commissioner Dominic.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Commissioner Atkins for the first time.
I would just like to get some clarity on the second motion, if it's a viable motion or not. I'm not taking a position. I just want legal counsel or someone to clarify the situation so we know how to proceed.
Mr. Bernstein, can we take that $1.25 million that's allocated for projects and put it in the general fund?
You could, but you could not use it for anything other than a road.
Okay.
Because that is dedicated tax money that the taxpayers directed only to be used for roads. So it actually ought to go into the road fund.
It stays in front.
And what I hear is you're proposing an amendment to the ordinance that instead of transferring the money into the capital outlay fund, to transfer it back to the public works fund?
Yes. Well, vote no would do that. Ms. Bryant. Yeah.
But this particular ordinance has not passed. There's nothing to transfer back.
Thank you.
Okay. You haven't passed a $1.25 million appropriation. Mm-hmm. That is now there, and then you're would need to send it back. There's nothing to send back. If this fails, nothing happens. Now, you can make an amendment to change it instead of going from Public Works to Capital Outlay. You could say Public Works to the general fund, but it still will be money that's available for roads, and as it's worded right now, for Dawson Road out of the general fund.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else, Mr. Commissioner Atkins? Commissioner Middleton?
I withdraw my second.
I withdraw my motion, yes.
All right. I call for the vote.
Can you call for the question?
Wait. I think we're back to the original.
We're back to the original.
Say again, I'm sorry.
We're back to the original.
Okay. Any call for the
question?
Okay. No. Wait. Okay.
Everybody has a right to speak.
Could you clear it and let's start over? Mr. Hopkins.
Oh, somebody should be right in there.
Good, okay. Commissioner Dominic.
Call for the question.
Exactly. He'd be the first one. He's already talking
right.
About it.
Yeah,
that's not he's right.
He hasn't spoken on the first motion.
He has spoken on the first motion.
All right.
And Robert Glass, the
Commissioner Chavez.
All right. Obviously, I'm a new commissioner to this. New as in only been here for 3 months. So I've seen this come up a time and time again. So I drove over there and I called Commissioner Everson and said, hey, I want to go look at this road and see what the heck's going on. Why does this keep on coming up, and how come everybody's so controversial over this topic? Robert Glass, if you'd come up, I'd like to get your knowledge on this because you know way more about this than I do.
That's
fine. For the drainage issue, I know Commissioner Everson mentioned two reasons why in my belief, we want to get this road fixed for the parish is, first, the drainage. Has that been fixed?
We think so.
Okay.
We've done the work was prior to the last rain, but you can't use the last rain. No, that was
right. But in the last rain, it was only 10 inches to drive through?
No, we think it was about, well, it lasted for about 10 or 11 hours, which.
And how deep was it?
Normally, I would even, maybe about ankle deep.
About, okay. I know in my district, I drove a truck through 6.5 feet deep water.
Well, we close the road. I mean, so anytime it gets pretty deep,
ankle deep.
We got to close the road.
So you believe, you being the expert in this room, more so than any one of us, that the drainage is up to par for now for a Caddo Parish road. Is that your expert opinion?
We think so.
Okay. I appreciate that. And the second topic is for medevac, for civilians, ambulatory services. Is there now a way for the citizens of that road in that area to get medevac service quickly and effectively?
Yes, there's a new station end of Jolly Napier, which is a very short distance from Dawson Road now. Prior to that, the station was many miles away, and it had to come a very long route, and it did take a long time, but that's been corrected.
Okay, so the two issues that I understand that are the issue have been corrected. To your knowledge, is there any other complaints that were brought to you that still need to be addressed?
Well, they also complained about being the limited access, one way in, one way out. Okay. That was part of the original.
Roads in Caddo Parish are like that?
A lot. I don't have a number, but a lot.
Okay. Would you say more than 100?
Just don't know. Maybe,
okay.
You know.
And
I really don't know.
If we fixed all of them at one point, too, we'd probably be broke if we fixed them all.
There are lots of dead-end roads in the parish.
All right. In the format of the road, when I went over there, my road on Blanc Boulevard is way worse than the potholes. My road is worse than that road. So as far as the pavement, it looks fine to me. Robert, that's all the expert questions I need on you. I appreciate your time. Erica, I do got a question for you. As far as financially sound, if we're going to spend $1.2 million on this road, is the return on investment that we're putting into the parish, is it worth it? In your expert opinion, should we spend this money?
Commissioner, what I can talk about is the soundness of the fund that you're wanting to take the monies from. And your Public Works Fund is one of your better funded funds that you have. that you all oversee. You have a sales tax that's specifically dedicated for both roads and solid waste, and you've generated a significant amount of sales tax over the years to be able to have $20 million fund balance in your road fund. It would take a lot of other numbers for me to be able to opine on whether or not it's financially sound for us in relation to this particular road.
Okay. Thank you, Erica. President, that's all I have.
Thank you. Commissioner Cawthorn, I believe.
My question is just a point of clarification. Mr. Commissioner Emerson asserted earlier that in 2014, this allocation was proposed and inadvertently left out of the budget.
Yes.
And but it was approved. Mm-hmm. But it was just left out of the budget.
Right. I'd ask Erica.
What you mean to ask Erica?
You know that's true. I found it.
So can you give me the background? I just want to get an understanding.
The commission approved, when it was approved in its 2014 budget, during that time, they approved $1.25 million to be placed in a 2014 budget. And when we would prepare the 2015 budget, they approved that we include in that budget another $1.25 million in the 2015 budget. In, that is just a recommendation that then has to be presented to the commission by administration. When we presented the budget to the commission, it was not included in there. The commission would have had the opportunity to include it at that time when they adopted, but that didn't happen. We realized later that we should have had it in there when we presented it to you all, and we tried to present an amendment to include it later, and that amendment failed.
Okay, so the $1.25 million that should have been appropriated in 14 was never included in the budget?
No, there was $1.25 million included in 14.
Okay.
It was supposed to be an additional $1.25 million recommended to the commission by administration for the 15 budget. You could not automatically approve it for 15 because the 15 budget was not before you at that time.
Okay.
So in order to get it in the 15 budget, it would have had to been initially either a recommendation from administration or an amendment from the commission to include it in there. Administration did not recommend it as asked by the commission when they approved it for the 2014 budget, and the commission did not amend it at that time when the 15 budget was adopted.
All right, so at this juncture, the original intent was for the repair of the Dawson Road.
Sir?
The original intent of this allocation was for the capital outlay.
The original intent was to have $2.5 million in the budget for Dawson Road.
Okay.
One appropriation in 14, one appropriation in 15.
Okay, all right. That's it.
Commissioner Jackson.
I have some questions that may not even be relevant to this particular case. It is a finance question. Ms. Burns, you said there's $20 million in that fund, or somewhere round about. You don't have to give me a hardcore number. Round about such.
The road fund has a
pretty
balance.
Good fund balance. Yeah. Now, my understanding is I thought those road dollars were dedicated to a specific area, so they can't just be used on any road, right?
Oh, no, they can be used on any parish road.
Parish road. Okay, so this road that we're talking about is outside the city limits.
It's in the parish.
Okay. Well, because I consider city road, I consider city of Shreveport road
close,
as
yeah,
in the parish as well. So, but I know, I see what you're saying. I see the separation.
Yeah,
my separation is a little different from
other. Roads that are considered assets of the parish.
Gotcha.
and accounting for in our asset listing as roads.
Gotcha. Okay.
City does theirs, state does theirs,
gotcha.
City does ours.
Okay, that was just a point of clarification for me. The other one is, and I guess this may be your question of Dr. Wilson, or maybe even the attorney's question is, I just heard you in your comments to Commissioner Cawthorn say that it was in the 14 budget, 1.25, right? There was an option to recommend it in 15, and it was left out. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
So are you saying that administration did not recommend that?
Right. When Dr. Wilson presented his 2015 budget, there was not a recommendation included in there for the $1.25 million for Dawson Road.
Okay.
But
and that's where I guess I may get to the attorney. So
So what we're voting on now is a, is this correcting a technical error, or is this?
Yes.
Because I guess what I'm trying to figure out is this a technical error, or is this administration left it out of the budget and it just did not get approved?
Well, now remember, we can only recommend. Administration only recommends. To put it, actually put it in the budget, the commission would have to vote to do that and get 7 votes. But when Dr. Wilson presents his budget to this commission, it's purely, it's a recommendation. Right. We received indication from the commission that they wanted that in there because you approved, you said they approved that when they approved the 2014 budget.
Right.
That's right. So administration should have had it as a recommendation because of the commission. Yes, it should have been a recommendation.
The original intent was for it.
But what I want to just clarify, I want to clarify that it could not be in the budget. It was not left out of the budget. It was left out of his recommendation to you.
Okay.
His proposed budget.
Oh, no, that's the clarification for me. Appreciate it. Yes, that's it. Appreciate it, Mr. President.
Commissioner Johnson, I believe you haven't spoken.
Okay. I'm going to try to clarify this better than anybody else at one point in time.
Good.
There was, at the original motion was a $2.5 million. Well, that failed, and it was a tie, and we ended up locking down the budget for 2014. I made the motion. I made the motion to do 1.25 for 2014, 1.25 for 2015. Just like we do with the biomed and the EAP, we did the 500,000 for 5 years. So if it's in the budget, if the motion passed, then it would automatically go into the budget on the proposed budget. We would then have to vote on it. Well, it wasn't in the proposed budget. And so when it wasn't in the proposed budget and we passed 2015 budget, it got omitted. Tried to bring it back in. Well, the players who was a part of the play in the beginning to make it sure that it did get in the budget so that we could pass the 2014 budget now come back and say, well, we don't want to support it. So that was happening. If it had made it into the 2015 budget, it would have passed because it would have been harder to take it out of the budget than to put it back in. So therefore, it's a technicality that happened. And all Commissioner Epperson is trying to do is correct the technicality. Now, Public Works have to go through and figure out how much it costs to do whatever they're going to do with Dawson Road. If they don't use the money goes back, it stays into Public Works and stays into this capital outlay fund. It don't go nowhere else. The residents on Dawson Road can't put it in their pockets. It stays in Public Works. So if they can't use the 2.5, it's just not used. Simple. Thank you.
Commissioner Dominic.
I call for the question.
Second.
The question was called by Commissioner Dominic, seconded by Commissioner Jackson. Please vote. That passes. We're voting on the issue now.
Voting on the original.
Right.
Original.
Okay, I was going to call a question. Now this is the vote for it.
As written.
Okay.
Right. The original ordinance. Okay. The original ordinance as written.
Okay. This is ordinance 5568.
Ten, 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 ten.
6-5.
No, that's 6-6.
No, it's not.
Six, I think it takes 7 to spend money.
6-5.
Yeah, I know it's 6, yes.
Okay. That pass?
I don't think so.
D7 to pass.
Legal? D7 to pass.
It's embarrassing.
It's an ordinance.
Take 7 votes.
Yes, sir. Seven.
Come on now. Officers? Yes. Voluntary? So it doesn't pass.
Majority pass. Doesn't pass.
Majority of membership.
Let's move on.
Wait, okay. He said majority of membership. Yeah, which is 7.
Yeah. Thank you.
Bud Storm is absent.
Aye.
Ordinance number 5573 of 2016, emergency ordinance authorizing emergency aid to those who were affected by the 2016 flood.
So move.
That is moved by Commissioner Epperson and second by Commissioner Johnson. Would you like to speak on your motion?
This includes the flooding of March of 2016, basically using the same parameters and policies and guidelines as the 2015 Red River flooding, as well as the tornado disaster in the Blanchard area.
Commissioner Johnson, did you want to speak?
Not now.
Okay, Commissioner Dominic, you're on the board.
Is this, if the way I'm reading this, and I remember us talking about this the other day, it was the remaining money that was left over from the emergency, is $400,000 left over. And they will make a report to us based upon the $150,000 increments.
Right. Same price.
Same price, and it's going to be through
CCC,
okay. Thank you.
I'd like to make a substitute motion to put on hold $56,991.36 for the possible reimbursement of Northwest Louisiana VOAD, which would include the Catholic Charities for $5,050.46, Goodwill Industries for $5,000 even, Red Cross for $17,200, Food Bank of Northwest Louisiana for $15,022.90, the Salvation Army for $6,793, for St. Vincent de Paul for $5,000 even, and for United Methodist Relief Group for $2,925. If I could have a second on that, I'd like to speak on it.
I'll second.
Okay. Substitute motion was made by the chair and second by Commissioner Atkins. When we have catastrophic events that happen in Caddo Parish, which seem to be happening far too often, we take on several partners within this. When we had this event happen in 2015, when we had the flooding in 2015, the Caddo Parish Commission set aside, I believe, $750,000 for relief. We provided relief to all of the citizens of Caddo Parish, and we also ended up with $400,000 left over. That $400,000 that was left over after providing relief to the citizens did not fulfill the request that we made to agencies to help out. And this $56,991.36 will make these agencies whole. And on a later a day, when we want to vote for this, it can go through non-governmental appropriations on a later day. But we set aside $750,000 for relief. The citizens were taken care of. There's agencies that did our work for us, and to make them whole, to help the parish out and to help the citizens out on another day, we need to bring them whole out of this $400,000 that we have left over, and we just need to save this $56,991. And that is a very simple request that I'm asking this body to make, that of this money that we're allocating for 2016 relief, that we recognize that we have obligations from 2015 that in my eyes have not been fulfilled. Would you like to speak on your second, Commissioner Atkins?
No, you said enough, President Lynn.
Everybody on the board wants to speak on this. Commissioner Chavez.
I need a point of information, Mr. Chair.
Okay, a point of information.
Your motion again is mute. This is an emergency ordinance. It has to go specifically for what it's on the agenda for.
And instead of spending the full amount of $400,000, we need to recognize that the flood relief, the residual money left over, that instead of spending the full amount in there, that we lower that dollar amount.
The motion is illegal.
I don't think the motion is illegal.
It's not what you think, it's what it is.
The ordinance before the commission enlarges the scope of who can receive emergency aid from the commission's funds to include citizens that were affected by the March 2016 flooding. It's simply the subject matter of the ordinance is to make a group of people eligible for aid from the fund that was set aside. It does not appropriate money. It does not. It's not a fiscal ordinance as such.
Okay. With that, I'd like for us to recognize that that money is still owed, and yeah. I'll put it on the next agenda, or bring it. I'll bring it to non-governmental appropriations. Commissioner Chavez, I'll present that.
Thank you, President. First off, I don't want anybody taking this the wrong way by them thinking that I don't care about the people that got harmed by the flood. However, in making everybody whole, I want to check with legal. Since we were declared a disaster, is FEMA going to reimburse those people for those funds that they spent? Is there a reason for us to spend the Caddo Parish dollars when FEMA is going to come in with federal dollars and people can submit their information as far as what happened at their homes and their businesses, and FEMA will reimburse them?
That's for the current flood, not the previous flood.
That's for legal.
Yes.
You're asking the question for the current flood.
Right, for what these funds that he wants for. For the people that just...
Can I answer that? I'm on.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess Commissioner Johnson will direct that question to you.
Okay. The way that the 2016 funds are set up and the way that CCAA is going to be set up is that they will have to go through the FEMA process first. And then if they need additional money, then it will come from the money that we have set aside.
That's right.
So they have to go through FEMA first and then parish money second.
All right. So in other words, this would not be duplicative of FEMA.
No.
Can we make sure that
if it goes the other direction, if they get the parish money first, then FEMA money will then be deducted.
Right.
So they basically have to go through FEMA first, and then if they don't meet, if they exceed what FEMA has said that they need, then they would come to the parish to get the supplemental money to finish and make the house back whole like it should be.
So we're gonna make the citizens whole after they've already submitted their claim to FEMA, right? Or they're going to
if they need additional.
If they need additional.
Okay, that's all I needed to know. So, thank you.
And I wouldn't say that we're going to make them whole. It's just additional assistance available if they need it.
Right, Commissioner Epperson, thank you for introducing this.
Commissioner Johnson.
Okay, I guess I still need some clarification on that. Your amendment.
I withdrew it, but you'll see it later.
Okay.
Main motion.
Call for the question.
Second.
I thought. Well, he can't. You can't speak and then call for the question.
No, I had a point of clarification.
Yeah,
I was talking about for his floor.
What do we both know?
Call for the question.
Yes.
That passes. Okay, let's vote.
Let's vote.
That passes.
Next, we move to ordinances for introduction by title. Ordinance number 5569 of 2016, ordinance amending the budget of estimate revenues and expenditures for capital outlay in the amount of $725,000 to provide an appropriation for law enforcement equipment. Ordinance number 5570, an ordinance amending the budget investment revenues and expenditures for capital outlay fund in the amount of $475,000 to provide an appropriation for a sewer project for the town of Greenwood. Ordinance number 5571, ordinance declaring certain adjudicated properties to be surplus and authorize the parish administrator or designee to sell parish's tax interests. Ordinance number 5572, rescinding the subdivision of Country Haven Subdivision, Unit 1. Ordinance number 5574, authorizing emergency aid to those who were affected by the 2015 flood and the December 27th, 2015 tornado. Next, we move to ratify the work session minutes for April the 4th.
Move.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Jackson, second by Commissioner Dominic. Please vote. That passes. Next item.
Next, move to resolutions. Resolution number 14, requesting special exemptions to the requirement of RS-18532 that no precinct shall contain less than 300 registered active voters within geographical boundaries.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Jackson, second by Commissioner Dominic. Please vote. That passes. Next item.
Resolution number 15, urging Congress to pass Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act.
So move.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Jackson, second by Commissioner Bowman, I believe. Please vote. That passes. Next item.
Resolution number 19, authorizing the Caddo Community Action Agency Incorporated to administer the Head Start program.
So move.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Dominic, second by Commissioner Jackson. Please vote.
Cawthorn.
Oh, excuse me. Second by Commissioner Cawthorn. That passes.
Authorized resolution number 20, proclaiming supporting sexual assault awareness and prevention month.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Johnson, second by Commissioner Middleton. Please vote.
No, I have nothing to do with it.
Passes. Resolution number 21, resolution authorizing the administrator to add stipulations to the EAP cooperative endeavor.
So moved.
Second.
Do you want to make an amendment to that?
I thought you were going to make an amendment.
Yeah, you're right.
Sorry. We're making an amendment to change the 80% to the majority, and then for the funds paid back, just to pay back the services that were received to Caddo Parish.
Second.
That was moved by Commissioner Chavez and seconded by Commissioner Jackson.
You need to explain. You have to
right. And let me go ahead and explain on what I'm doing here. The EAP is obviously, it's a great program and we appreciate what they're doing. However, there needs to be a little more protocols in place as far as if we're giving them Caddo Parish funds to use to build entrepreneurship here in Caddo Parish, I feel that we should have some type of stipulation that those businesses that they bring here should stay here for at least a duration of 10 years. And of those 10 years, at least have a certain amount of the administration, the ownership, living here incumbent, running the businesses. Now, obviously, at first we had an 80% clause, but we've met with the EAP and they agree that having majority will suit their needs, and I agree with that as well. At the end of the day, the majority will always be more than 50% of whomever is working there. They have the staff, the administrator, and the personnel within Caddo Parish. So I feel that that's going to be very good for us as far as the return on the investment. We're giving them the funds. They're going to bring entrepreneurship here, and this is going to verify that whoever they bring and they help raise up to be a good business here will stay here, at least for the time to get our money back, or to just really live here and realize that Caddo Parish is a great place to live and they don't want to go anywhere else anyway. So appreciate your guys' support on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Chavez. Commissioner Atkins.
Well, Mr. President, as you know, as an angel fund investor, I abstain on any EAP vote, so I'll be abstaining from this discussion and this vote.
Thank you. Thank you for that clarification. Commissioner Johnson.
Mr. Bernstein, in the original cooperative endeavor agreement, isn't all the businesses and everything supposed to be in Caddo? I think when we initially passed all of this, the stipulation was that everything would be in Caddo.
I don't have that in front of me, but I don't know that that came up in the committee that was in the original agreement.
Okay. I want to say that it is, because I want to say that it was Commissioner Thibodeau, because that was one of his main sticklers on any and every subject, especially if we were going to be spending some money, is that it remains in Caddo Parish. And I do notice that in the last report that there were six companies that actually settled outside of Caddo Parish, and I never heard where those six landed at, what parish or what county or where they ended up going to. But, I mean, if we're using Caddo Parish money, taxpayers' money, to help run and fund this particular program, then we ought to be able to make sure that 100% of the companies stay here and that it's not a majority. And I think we got to get away from utilizing other people's, what would be best for them, what's best for us, and what's best for Caddo Parish, and what's best for the people that we represent, and not the organization in which we're trying to do business with. So I like the original one better than I do the amended one, but at the same time, I want to make sure that everything stays in Caddo if we're going to be funding it, and if y'all like to spend the money with them, then I think it should be 100% Caddo. Unless some other parishes step up and spend money with them, then they can play in the game. But otherwise, they should be out of the game.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. Commissioner Dominic?
Yeah, I move to postpone this till next meeting, if I can get a second.
Second.
I do know, can I speak?
Yes, yeah. Okay. Substitute motion was made by Commissioner Dominic and second by Commissioner Epperson to postpone this to the next meeting.
You guys, I'm going to support you guys, but we have some questions here. Commissioner Johnson's bringing up, asking legal, and they can't give the answer. I think what we need to do is look at the original documents to see. But just for you guys who weren't there, we were in Economic Development Committee meeting. This was kind of the compromise, so I think that's what we're looking at. But I don't think we need to make a – this is not anything that we have to do today. I think we need to get this answered. Henry, or you, if Donna can get with us and let us know.
Sure. It's easy enough. I don't have the original agreement in front of me.
The what?
I said I just don't have the original
agreement. I got you. I understand. So I'm going to ask that we postpone it until we get the answers.
Mr. Epperson, do you want to speak?
Ditto, with the exception of supporting.
Okay. Commissioner Chavez.
I'm all with you guys on moving it. At the end, I want us all to have a collaboration that we agree anything that we help fund stays here. But I would like to know, on what he just spoke of, is it all right if we suspend the rules and have him come up? Because I'd like to hear if six people took some money from Caddo Parish and moved their business somewhere else. Okay.
So you'd have to make your motion at the beginning of when you spoke.
All right, we'll talk about that when we move it, because I'd like to find out about that.
Thank you. Everybody please spoke. No one else is on the board.
Vote to postpone.
Postpone.
We're
voting on the substitute motion to postpone this vote to the next meeting.
Y'all should have made him the president.
And that passes.
Yeah.
Next item, please.
Resolution number 22-2016, resolution opposing the decision of MPC case C-616.
So moved.
Second. That was moved by Commissioner Epperson and second by Commissioner Johnson. Would you like to speak on your motion?
Yes, sir. When I asked for you all to accommodate me on advancing this for the agenda today, I stated that I would provide you information, which I did. I think I gave you hard copies. I gave you electronic copies. I think we downloaded a copy of the video of the MPC meeting on March 16th. Just to go through some things in the initial application, I saw in there where it stated that the parish was maybe proposing to build a road from Greenwood Road or Highway 80 to Jefferson Page. On the minutes of July the 23rd, which I provided, we had an economic development meeting. I had asked for some information relative to cost of the property that the proposal was on. I wanted the appraised value of it as is, and then I wanted it with the so-called improvements that they were going to do. They also stated about the road that on the September the 14th, 2015 Economic Development Committee meeting, it says there was a discussion regarding a certified industrial park in West Caddo Parish. Mr. Glass pointed out the tract of land on the map along with the proposed road from Highway 80. Mr. Glass also pointed out that a portion of the road would be in the city limits. Mr. Ward stated that there are some issues with drainage and wetlands in this area. A bridge would need to be constructed. He stated that the parish would need to fund approximately $7.1 million for a little over a mile, and the city would need to fund about $2.1 million for about 6,500 feet. If you look on the site plan, we just discussed the drainage situation around the Dawson Road, Jefferson Page, Jolly Napier, all those areas that north of Greenwood Road where this proposal would be. If we clear all that land and put concrete out in a big 1.4 million square foot building or whatever is there, where is that water going to naturally gravitate to? It's going north to Jefferson Page Road, encompassing Dawson Road, making it worse than what it is, and all those points north of it, all the way down to Cross Lake, where I imagine that's where it drains to. Also, it should be noted that during the deliberations of the Zoning Commission, there were 34 persons that spoke in opposition to the zone. There was a petition of 287. We had one lady, Miss Jimmy Mae Harrison off of Greenway Place. She changed her mind, stated that she didn't understand what the petition was. So we scratched that one from the petition. That's 286 on the petition. I think the mayor spoke in favor of it. I believe Mr. Franks, the engineering firm, the parish CEO, Scott Martinez from North Louisiana Economic Partnership, that was basically the people that was there. My question was, including members of the MPC, how many of them had lived within that area? And I would like to ask this body, how many of you have actually crossed over the two-lane crossing on I-20 in Industrial Drive, where it dead ends in the Greenwood Road that runs into the property that we are speaking about? A two-lane road over I-20. It's not a week go by that an 18-wheeler doesn't turn over in that heavy circle where they're coming down to go to Petro. Right. They're building a new truck wash on the southeast side of I-20 and Industrial Loop. They're building a new freight line or distribution center for trailers and tractors and maintenance directly across from the General Electric plant between Wendy's and 70th Street. We got Petro truck stop. We already have a number of 18-wheeler organizations located up and down that particular area. When you go from Calderwood basically west toward Washington Lane, which will be the first street, and Greenwood Acres, it is no way that though we should have to go through that amount of obstruction with all of those 18 wheels in that particular traffic. Less than a mile and a half south of where we are now, we have 524 acres, we have rail spurs, we have multiple lane concrete highways that's already in place, everything that you need. I think the parish even has some land that's open next to General Electric. Correct me if I'm right. I don't know how much it is. I think we got about 88 acres on down the road from where the new Jordache plant is located on West 70th Street, just west of West Park Drive where our compactor site is. There's ample land for us to have an industrial site without impeding in this community. I was highly opposed about the way that some of the MPC members, it appears to me that they stated that to reject this would be foolish. Well, I don't think 34 people that came to state their opposition was foolish, and 286 that signed the petition were foolish. And I think one of the members even stated that it was uneducated. I don't know what that meant. Because people want to preserve their neighborhoods. Is anything wrong with that? This is a square peg that does not fit in that round hole. Secretary Sean Wilson, the newly appointed director of Louisiana Department of Transportation, spoke at our Police Jury Association conference. The price of gasoline is extremely low. And you know that's where we get one of the majority of our funds for our roads. So where are we going to get the money to extend Highway 80 as well as widen that interchange there, which is already highly trafficked with 18 wheels, and going to be even more so with the new Freightliner dealership that's located and the new truck wash directly adjacent from Petro Truck Stop. I don't know how many of you live there, but I've been going down that road 15 years. I came down there 2 years prior to building my home up there, which is, I've been there 13 years now. There's a lot of prostitution, a lot of crime going on there. You got to know it. They walk in that strip going to those truck stops. The area is changing. Timberline and Deer Timberline spends about $10,000 a year on our ingress, and we have three ingresses and egresses to our community. Every 6 months, an 18-wheeler come down there and crush up the sprinkler system. And probably once a year, somebody run into our brick wall and our wrought iron fencing because they're lost. The people aren't foolish. Yes, we need economic development.
I'll entertain a motion to extend Mr. Epperson's time.
Second.
It is the people's wish and their concern to maintain the integrity of their neighborhoods.
Okay, there was no motion. Is that a motion to extend Commissioner Epperson's time? Okay, motion made by Commissioner Johnson, second by Commissioner Cawthorn. Passed by acclamation. There's no opposition. Okay, keep on.
And I hope nobody can state that Ken Epperson is against economic development. My 21-year record here would certainly put that to squash. It'll be a total lie. We have Lube Tech that's located out there. Even when we had the oil boom with Chesapeake and all the drilling coming in, it was myself and Mr. Thibodeau that made the motion to put in the reserve trust fund and the oil and gas fund, making sure that we were fiscally prudent and responsible with the money that's coming in for the taxpayers. So no one can ever say that. No one whatsoever. My concern is the wishes of those citizens, the 34 that spoke in opposition, the 286 on the petition, had a valid concern. There will be repercussions and problems with drainage that's going to be gravitating north to Jefferson Page and going to worsen the situation, which you all didn't even allow the chance to try to rectify the situation, which I asked to do with that $1.25 million. See if we can make it better. It was stated also that they spoke with community leaders and individuals. There's no one that keep their constituents as informed as Ken Epperson does. I got the documentation to prove it. January 28th, largest community meeting held. Scott Martinez was there. Mr. Sweeney was there. They never mentioned this problem, this particular project. They had the opportunity to mention it there before the people. This isn't anything that happened overnight. July the 30th, 2015, I think I gave you all a copy of a West Caddo Economic Development Summit that was held out there. Some of the players that may be sitting in here now, they were there. Never mentioned. Had a full house, couldn't get anyone else in. The thing about it is being fair. When you talk to the people, you let the people know what's going on, you can broker a deal most times. Charles Kirkland came to us when the Amazon deal came in. We met upstairs, but it never reached to that point. But to come out and say that you're going to create 1,500 to 4,000 jobs, that's a fallacy. That's a speculation. Show me in black and white where you have somebody, what they call a shovel ready, or ready to open their pocketbook up to come and create 1,500 jobs and 4,000 jobs. I'll rally that community together and we'll sell that thing. But I think this was something that was done underhandedly. It's not fair. They were totally disrespectful of the citizen that came down. They made a mockery of them. And I would ask that each of you would look at that MPC tape in its entirety, from start to finish. Somebody mentioned something about they left so early we was going to have ice cream and cake. They made a joke about a smokestack. That's not the way that we treat citizens. We're the appointed people. The people elected us. We appoint the members on that board. Those persons are supposed to represent the citizens of Caddo Parish. Section 1-01 of our parish charter spells that out. So I ask that you would support this resolution and ask the city council to oppose that particular situation. Thank you.
Commissioner Johnson, would you like to speak on your second?
Yes, I'd like to speak because I don't know how I may speak later on.
You know, I have to echo some of the things that Commissioner Everson said. I'm totally for economic development. But with economic development, you have to do certain things, I feel. This piece of property is certified, and so it should be ready. It should be ready for whatever company wants to come in to do whatever they need to do. To change the zoning this early will have anybody that stays in that area wondering what's going on. I mean, if you look at some in the past of Shreveport and Caddo Parish, of people wanting to put certain businesses in front of Spring Lake, Southern Trace, and it could be as small as a gas station. Nope, they ain't want it. It didn't happen. And so that group of citizens came down, and they basically, it was 200 of them, I think, on the petition that says that, you know, hey, we don't want it. And a lot of it's probably due to education. I mean, if they knew exactly what type of industry is in this I-1, and they get with the developer and tell them, you know, we're good with this, 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 and this, but if this type of business come in as the I-1, we're against it. I think there should be more communication. And then once you do decide on a potential tenant for that particular area, then get the community involved, do the zoning change, and make it happen. I think doing it this early, there's a lot of possibilities that could come out. Now, of all the economic development stuff that I've seen in the past, we know potentially how many new jobs are going to be created, what the average salary was going to be. We don't know none of that. And typically what type of business it could be. We don't need to know what the name of the company is, what they're going to make, but exactly what type of industry it is. To say that this is what we got at the table and this is what is potentially to come there. But just to say that one person says 4,000 jobs, another person says 1,000 jobs, how many jobs is it? I mean, I can sit that back and say I got 5 acres of land and I could put a building there and it can employ 500 people. But is that right? And is that true? Don't know. So we just need to have more concrete information. You know, even though this won't be appealed to us, it'll be appealed to the city council. But I would ask that the city council ask those questions because, I mean, it's on them. And those citizens rely upon the people who they elected to represent them to make the best decision on their behalf. And if, you know, you have a situation where everybody's just blind because they see 4,000 jobs and you do whatever, you sell yourself for 4,000 jobs, that's not right. That's not what you should be doing. You should have more communication, get down to what's actually are the two or three companies that are going to come here, need to know the name, but what type of industry it is, let the community get involved and say, okay, we can live with that or we can't live with that, and then move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Jackson.
You know, it's hard for me as Commissioner of District 3 sitting back listening to what I just heard about not respecting citizens, about citizens coming down here to petition their government and being disrespected, when the very first resolution that was passed out of this body was a resolution to send I-49 through Allendale. And citizen after citizen after citizen came down here and petitioned this body not to oppose it, but to postpone it. And we looked at every last one of them and told them, "Yo, what you got to say don't matter."
As president,
I got the floor. I got the floor. I got the floor. Point of order. I got the floor. I didn't interrupt you. I got the floor.
Commissioner Jackson has the floor.
But it has nothing to do with the commissioner.
Parliamentary. Don't interrupt me.
Jackson has the floor.
When my residents came down here and asked y'all to postpone it, not oppose it, we don't know one single job that I-49 inner city connector is gonna bring. We don't even know that it's gonna be funded. But we passed it right on out of here.
And every last one of those neighbors and residents came down here and asked you to postpone it. We didn't listen to them. And I've heard them call worse.
Again, point of order.
I got the floor, Commissioner Johnson. If you would appreciate it, I didn't interrupt you. If you would appreciate, the same respect be returned.
Commissioner Jackson has the floor.
Would you tell them that I'm right about this?
Can you repeat what you're saying?
Basically, he has to be discussing the motion and not about something that's outside of the motion.
I'm getting to the motion.
You're getting to it, but it's not about the motion.
Commissioner Jackson's got the floor, and that's point of privilege of the president. Continue.
And so if we're going to get into talking about respecting citizens and respecting the character of a neighborhood, you're going to run over a whole neighborhood with I-49. This thing here doesn't do anything to the neighborhood. There's a 150-foot buffer put in place to protect and preserve the character of the neighborhood. This is, in my opinion, a complete waste of the public's time. The fact that we're even considering this, one, it's gone through the MPC. The appellate process is, at this point, is to go to the city council. They have a process to go through. For us to even be weighing in on this, it's foolish. The developer has taken his own personal time and money to bring this spot up to par. We missed an opportunity already. Texas got Amazon. Open the paper up today, Texas talking about this new Facebook data center that they're about to open. $500 million investment. That could have been right here. Why? Because Texas was ready. If you don't have the opportunity, if you don't create the opportunity, it's just like James Brown said, don't give me nothing. But if you let me open the door, I'll get it myself. But you got to create the opportunity. And if we sit here and don't create this opportunity and we continue to obstruct everything that tries to come here, we'll never be a city or a parish on the grow. Right now, those trees sitting out there don't bring anything to the parish of Caddo. Those trees don't pay any taxes. Those trees can't buy a house. Those trees don't buy cars. But you have somebody who's trying to bring jobs to this area. And for us to sit back and not have a counteroffer, we do have a counteroffer on the table, which we spent $7.5 million to preserve a GM plant that's become a total clusterfuck.
Whoa.
And everybody, most of the folks sitting around here supported it.
Nobody's going to call that to order?
And we have sat here. Boy. We have sat here and wasted the public's time on a zoning change. The state hadn't asked us to spend one penny on this. For you to bring up something that was passed in a previous committee with new members here, that's how insane is that? There's a whole new committee in place. We haven't considered paving a road out there. We haven't considered doing anything out there. All we're trying to do is create the opportunity, as opposed to us having a complete show with what we have with Elio Motors and the $7.5 million that we spent on that and no jobs in sight. So how do we sit here and say, you got somebody who's spending their own personal money, got their own skin in the game, hadn't asked the parish for one dime. We're going to tell them, no, you don't deserve it. We don't even have the authority to tell them no. We sticking our nose in somebody else's business. Let the city council do their job. If you feel you want to object, you go down to the city council meeting on next Tuesday and oppose it. But to put this parish and to put this body in a position to weigh in on something that we have no authority on, that's crazy. That is insane to me. Now, when you're right, I'm a supporter. I support it. The technical error that took place with the 1.25. But we shouldn't even be talking about this. And I'd rather have Scott Martinez out showing a prospect around as opposed to him sitting 3 hours in a meeting, wasting his time. Mr. Jelks should be out trying to figure out another way to advertise this property. He didn't approach the state approached him. And we continue to see these folks say, well, Caddo ain't ready, so we just gonna go over to Bossier. Caddo ain't ready, we'll go to DeSoto. They got space. And these people or these municipalities are benefiting off the failure and foolish policies and practices of Caddo Parish and Shreveport. And we got to change that tide. And as long as I'm up here and as long as I'm over the Economic Development Committee, I'm going to advocate against it. Because we cannot continue. How are we going to grow this area? We're sitting up here blocking somebody who's trying to bring jobs here. I'm offended. I apologize to you, sir. Because you have better things to do with your time. I went to a program this morning where Goodwill just opened a job center on North Market. The room filled with folks thinking there's opportunity out here. So they're going to go through a program, get them ready, get them trained for jobs that don't even exist. But we're going to sit here and say, oh, somebody who's trying to bring jobs, we're going to block you because you hadn't came and talked to us. That's the point of the zoning change to go out. They had the opportunity to come down. The zoning commission made that decision. Competent and skilled staff has weighed in on it.
Motion to extend your time.
I'm wrapping up.
Okay.
I'm just going to ask that this body not set another precedent, because we've already set one, that we not set another precedent for sticking our nose into something that we don't have any business getting into. Why? Because somebody hadn't come kiss the ring or somebody hadn't come traded horses or whatever with somebody. We got to get out of that business. It's a new age
motion
for economic development.
Motion by the chair to extend Commissioner Jackson's time.
So moved.
Moved by the chair, second by Commissioner Bowman. Y'all want to vote?
Yeah.
What are we doing?
I'm done.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Commissioner Atkins.
Wow, there was a lot of passion in that discussion. I have to say I agree with most of the points that Commissioner Jackson made. I will ask us all to try to manage our passion in a way that keeps us professional, and particularly with respect to our language, and guard our language accordingly. That being said, this is a jobs-oriented opportunity we have here. I have not heard any details on the project, but I certainly want to be supportive of any major employer that might be coming to our area. And with over 300 acres of site-ready LED, North Louisiana Economic Partnership-approved property ready to go, I just want to get government out of the way and let this happen. Let's let people know that Caddo Parish is ready for business and not ready to clog up the train here. So let's please support this project. It's a very viable project. We've got to be ready for the next major employer that comes to our region. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Atkins. Attorney Bernstein, did you want to say something?
Yes, just as a point of order. Since Commissioner Epperson had provided to ensure compliance with the open meetings law, the materials that Commissioner Epperson provided you all, we need to get a copy of that to the clerk to attach to the minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Since Christy. That's part of the consideration of the matter.
Thank you. Commissioner Bowman.
Thank you, Mr. President. I think we've spent a lot of time on this. I just basically want to say that I, too, am for the citizens. And when citizens come up and they want to express, you know, that's what we're here for, to answer primarily their cause and for their safety. That's what we're here for. But at the same time, I'm always for jobs, and I'm going to be for jobs as long as it's not going to inadvertently affect those citizens in whatever area in which we're talking about. If it's not a toxic waste plant or something like that being put up, I would get that, you know, something that would be caused bodily harm or be a public safety issue. But this is not that. This is something of opportunity. I don't see many other people trying to give jobs, and then every time someone comes, we cut it off. So I'll support it.
Thank you, sir. Commissioner Cawthorn.
Hey, this is a classic struggle that every major southern mid-sized city has gone through. It's the controversy between progress and preservation. That's the opportunity to bring a new company here, jobs between 1,500, 4,000. Not exactly what number it will yield, but it's an opportunity, and it's an opportunity that this local community needs. And then on the other hand, you've got preservation. You've got people who have built homes out in that neighborhood. They've been there for a while, and they're creating angst as to what their property going to look like after this plant comes here. In every negotiation, I fundamentally believe to every problem there's a solution. And I want to also state this. I don't think that we should, as a body, start issuing resolutions that we don't have governance over. That's some resolutions that are kind of softball we can move forward with. But I fundamentally think that what we need to do with this right here is to go back and negotiate and see how other cities have grown. The reality, I think that the residents who spoke at the MPC on the 16th, their concern is this. I don't know what type of facility is going out there. The one lady that was opposed to it, who was a part of the petition, Ms. Harrison, who lived on Greenway, she said they thought it was going to erect a meat plant or something. And after she said finally it was different, she was going to go to doors and explain to the other residents. I fundamentally think that there are a couple of things that need to happen when they go to the city council. We need to sit down with the stakeholders, the residents, and the community leaders of that organization, the investment group who's done a great job of being looking forward to getting this thing shovel ready so they can come in, and with the city council. And sit down amongst ourselves and say, hey, if as it relates to the company that's coming, is it going to be a toxic chemical plant? Is it going to be someone that's going to emit a fume, a stench in the community? We don't want that. But if it's going to be enclosed assembly or this sort of thing, or similar to Amazon, we good with that. Then we go over this side and say, eventually, the price of oil is going to go back up. Now, how much money the state is going to have to widen the highway, I don't know. But that's the possibility that we can have a discussion about the egress and the widening of those highways, widening of the streets, so that it becomes a win-win for everybody. And then if those things can't happen, we just have to do what we have to do. But I think that's a solution to every problem, and I think it needs to start with what we just described, with bringing to the city council, having that discussion, because that's where the road, that's where the buck stops. Sit down and conversate. That's how our city grows. That's how our city prospers. You can go to Austin, you can go to San Antonio, and I guarantee you've had these type of issues, but I also guarantee there's been some sitting down amongst the players and stakeholders at the table, and it got worked out. That's all I have.
Thank you, Commissioner Cawthorn. That's it. Commissioner Bowman, what was your point of order?
I just wanted to, I can get it on the second time around. I know that the city council voted something dealing with extending or to have a meeting with the citizens.
That's anyway. That's not a point of order.
Okay.
Thank you. Commissioner Bowman.
Call for the question.
Second.
Mr. President?
Yes. Pardon me.
She can't speak.
Excuse me. Right now we call for the question, and there's no speaking at that point. Right now. She can't speak. There's no speaking right now. There is a process to which we could suspend the rules to allow you to come to the podium and speak. That has not been done. However, in the process of calling for the question has been called, and once the question has been called, the process for which takes place, which is the voting on that, and then the voting on the issue, and then after that, then we could suspend the rules to allow a person from the audience to speak. Thank you. And so the question has been called. Everybody, please vote.
This is just for the question, right?
Calling for the question.
Yes, sir.
End of discussion. End of debate.
Okay.
That passes. Now on the motion.
Okay, what is this?
Mr. Hopkins, will you reread that? Did you want to? Everybody knows what it is?
The motion is Resolution 22, Resolution opposing decision of MPC zoning case C-616.
That fails. Next item, please.
Next, move to resolution number 23, resolution opposing House Bill 229 relative to including 17-year-olds to juvenile criminal justice system.
So move. Second.
Moved by Commissioner Epperson, seconded by Commissioner Jackson. Would you like to speak on your motion?
Yes, we started receiving some information from our Police Jury Association. I think I forwarded to Dr. Wilson and Randy and Ted and Clay Walker.
And it's been answered.
So they're working on, they're getting some figures now as to what it's going to cost the various juvenile detention centers. And also got a couple of figures from some more parishes.
Thank you. Commissioner Jackson, do you want to speak on your second?
No, I'd like to.
Okay, there's nobody up there. Please vote.
Lynn?
Oh, sorry, I hit the button. I guess too soon. Go ahead. That passes.
Resolution 24, proclaiming and supporting April 10 through 15 as National Crime Victim Rights Week.
Second. Me, motion.
Motion made by Commissioner Jackson. Who was the second?
Second.
Commissioner Cawthorn.
Yeah.
Upset. Commissioner Cawthorn is the second. Please vote.
Chavez, Bowman.
That passes.
Resolution number 25, urging members of the Northwest Louisiana Legislative Delegation and legislature to support Senate Bill 269.
Move to adopt.
Moved by Commissioner Jackson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner
Bowman.
Bowman.
Excuse me.
Do you want to speak on that? Do you want to speak on your motion, Commissioner Jackson?
Which one is it?
It's
26. 254. There's an opportunity here.
69.
There's an opportunity here for us to make a statement to our legislative delegation. As I said, we were down a couple of weeks ago, and I was a little disappointed to find that some of our legislators were not speaking on behalf of all of their constituents. And so we do. I know some folks have expressed reservations about putting these things out there, but they do turn to their local governing authority just to find out how do they feel about it. And I'd like for Caddo Parish to be on the record as supporting the collective interest of this bill. And I think it's an opportunity for us to move Louisiana in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Bowman, did you want to speak on your second?
No, sir.
Commissioner Dominic?
I kind of heard some of the stuff today. We don't need to get involved in passing things that we didn't have governance over, that we don't need to be sticking our nose into items that we don't have any authority over, unlike the one that we just passed with regards to the juvenile matter. I think we had a dog in that hunt. I mean, we run the juvenile detention system, the juvenile detention center, that if that bill passes, we're going to have an unfunded mandate upon us. But we have elected legislators that do their job, and I just have somewhat of a problem passing resolutions and sending them down to Baton Rouge on these issues, which some people are going to be for and some people are going to be against, and us getting involved in that. We do have some tax renewals coming up in a few years, and I don't want to create a negative perception among anybody. It would be different if the Northwest delegation representatives were all together and came here and said they needed a resolution for us to support it. But as far as I'm concerned, I'm going to be voting, I know, against 25 and 26. You do what you want to, but that's my opinion.
Thank you. Commissioner Middleton?
I'm also voting no. The reason being, I started working when I was 12 years old, illegal as it was, I worked below minimum wage, $1 an hour. Minimum wage was $1.60. I think if we show support of this, we're closing the door for us kids in junior high school that may have an opportunity to make a little bit of money to help the family, whatever. I think it's going to close the door for a lot of folks. So for that reason, I'm going to say no.
Thank you. Commissioner Atkins?
My view is similar to Commissioner Dominic. I think that this issue, we don't have this issue's not within our scope right now. And if it were in our scope, we would be having debate and committee meetings and perhaps lectures and discussions with economists who would help us fully understand the issue. I don't think anyone around this horseshoe has a full grasp of all the issues involved here, including myself. And so I feel that it's inappropriate for us to vote on things without having it properly vetted by the organization and the individuals. And also think it's inappropriate for us to impose our views on those people in Baton Rouge who are currently vetting it. And they were hired, they were elected to make these particular decisions. We were elected to make our own decisions. So I'll be voting no.
Thank you. Commissioner Epperson.
I will certainly be voting yes. I'm very familiar with this situation relative to wages, having been a business person for 11 years, 77 to 88, and I paid my employees back then, which I had 13 employees. I had five locations. I had a contract at Barksdale Air Force Base, England Air Force Base, and three stores in Shreveport, and I paid them above minimum wage. And I've always had two pennies in my pocket, never been broke, never been hungry, because I treated my employees fairly. And we do have a dog in this hunt because we represent the same constituency in which those state legislatures represent. And some of us, when they get ready to run and we don't have an opponent, they're going to ask us to endorse them and help them. So what do you mean we don't have a dog in this hunt? So I just say you speak for yourself. But I'm speaking from experience. We're looking here talking about 1,500 to 4,000 jobs. Hell, I don't want nobody coming here talking about, you come up here and create 1,500 jobs and you pay $6.50 an hour because we don't have, you know what I mean? Hell, I want some people to be able to work and make a living where they can buy a home with decent wages. I know young ladies that work at CVS in the morning from 8 to 12 and then go to Popeyes from 1 to 4. And then go to churches on the weekend. Those are breadwinners. And I don't want my son, even though he's in college, and my daughter, they were good students. And so was I. I don't want them going out. They got skills on the computers just as good as anybody else. I don't want them going out talking about training for no $5.50 an hour. They know what they're doing. Thank you.
Commissioner Johnson.
I think we do have a dog in this hunt. With lower wages and no wages, you have increasing crime. So if a person had a job making more money, you look to see that there's reduction in crime. And we talk about, we have CCC that the sheriff has to run, and we're the highest incarcerated state and city high in the percentage. And so by having lower minimum wage, you tend to have more crime. You look at California and New York, if we talk about how it's going to hurt the economy and all that, those are one of the most populated states in the United States. And they're looking to raise their minimum wage to $15. The South is always lagging behind minimum wage for some unknown reason. I'll let you figure it out. But I think that we do have a dog in this hunt. We need to urge our legislators to look at increasing the minimum wage. By increasing the minimum wage, it gives people more disposable income, that they can do other things, which would then say that they'll have sales tax that they'll be paying, which then goes to the government, goes to the parish, goes to the city, goes to the state. So keeping the minimum wage low doesn't do nothing for us at all, but increasing the minimum wage will increase spending. If you don't want to increase the minimum wage, then you got to figure out a way to reduce inflation, bring inflation back down. So then the other point that I want you to realize too is that you as elected officials will sit here and vote against increasing the minimum wage when you have immigrants that come over into the United States and make more money on their minimum wage than the U.S. citizen does, because of prevailing wage act. So you kind of need to think about what you're doing and look at the whole bigger picture, just saying that a mom and pop store would lose some employees because they're gonna lose some of their profit. Or you have a company that's gonna lose some of their profit because they're not gonna be able to pay the $7.25, which they can get away with. If we're talking about increasing this 75 cents, which is about $30 a week, I mean, that's nothing. Minimum wage now, the $7.25 is like $14,500 a year. How do you expect somebody to live off of that? You're paying for them. You are paying for them. Why not increase the wage and so then they are paying to help move this government forward? Otherwise, they just sitting back, making minimum wage, and then you subsidizing everything that's coming into them. Raise the minimum wage. It's simple. It's nothing that we could do. It's just urging our state legislators to say, hey, think about it and should make it happen because the state needs money, the city needs money, and we need money. Even though you got some funds that got money in them, they could be emptied in the blink of an eye. So, you know, the more you make, the more you spend. And the more you spend, the more the government gets taxes from you. Thank you.
Commissioner Chavez.
I'm going to be really brief because obviously there's people that want to get out of here. I wanted to weigh in on this. Again, I'll echo what some other people said. I don't really think we should get involved with other people's houses and what they're doing at their house. That's why they got elected to take care of that. And then I hate the fact that I feel like we're killing the American dream with this minimum wage thing, but what happened to you can be a dropout of high school, work at Trejo's as a busboy, making $2.13 an hour, and work your way up to run an $84 million pipeline. That's what I did. Are we going to tell America and tell these guys at this legislation that, hey, you're good enough, that we're going to legislate your success, that this is the most that you can make? We're not here to tell people that this is the best you're going to be. This is the American dream. We need to make these people realize that these are entry-level positions, that they go to work for somebody, and they want to aspire to be better. They don't want to aspire to make $7.25 an hour 5 years later. They want to start out sweeping the floor and then running the restaurant. So we should be ashamed of ourselves that we're even considering looking at this to tell people that this is what you're good enough to be for the rest of your life. That's all I want to say on that. That's it.
Thank you. Commissioner Dominic.
I withdraw. I'll go ahead and
vote. Thank you. All right. No further comments. Let's vote. That passes. Next item, please.
Resolution number 26, urging members of the Northwest Louisiana Legislative Delegation and Louisiana Legislature to support Senate Bill 254 relative to equal pay for equal work.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Jackson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Cawthorn. You want to speak? Okay. No one's on the board. Please vote. That passes. Next item.
Resolution 28, urging the Louisiana Legislature to support SB 269 to provide an increase in state minimum wage.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Johnson. Second by Commissioner Jackson.
Did it early.
I don't see anyone on the board. Please vote.
Jackson.
That passes. Next item.
Resolution 29, proclaiming supporting April as National Child Abuse Prevention Month.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Johnson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Bowman. I see anybody on the board. Please vote. Next item.
We're good. Okay. Next, we move to old business. Confirm approval of Dawson Road drainage upgrades.
So moved.
Wait, excuse me. Hold on 1 second. Yes, Commissioner Johnson.
I just want to apologize to the body if I got out of control a little while. I'm sorry when I'm talking, and I guess maybe thought I was in the back somewhere, but I do apologize to the public as well for those that are watching. So excuse me, and please accept my apology. Thank you.
That's the problem. Commissioner Epperson, what was that? I
didn't. Second.
No, motion made by Commissioner Epperson, second by Commissioner Johnson. On which item?
It's the Dawson Road drainage upgrades, number
16.
Oh, that's old.
It's in our old business.
You read?
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. Now, we definitely got a dog in this hunt. All we're asking is the money is appropriated. Let's do the right thing. Those people, some of them have their own property address since 1860. Very good stewards in the community. Some of them have probably educated our kids. The Dawsons have probably coached our kids. The Timberlakes have taught our children. Reverend Wilbur Dawson has preached to us, and a number of other people in that area. All we're asking is to extend the Dawson Road and upgrade it, nine-tenths of a mile. The money is there. It's been appropriated to improve the quality of life for those residents on Dawson Road. And some of you, you know, I go back from 92 when they first had the bridge that went out up in that area. Whereas I wasn't even in that district. I was commissioning District 6. And I used to go up and get my pickup and go across the land and help people get in and out when those bridges was out. So just asking that the cost is there, the money is there. Let's vote in favor of that and give those people some redress. Thank you.
Commissioner Johnson, would you like to speak on your second? Commissioner Jackson.
Mr. Glass or Administrator Wilson. I'm a little confused, all right? I don't know. So we were supposed to, what we did earlier that didn't pass.
That was for additional funds.
That was what, so.
This one is the project that came on in 2014 to extend the road.
So where would the money from that come from?
The money was appropriated in the 2014
that's the
budget.
One
that was the original 1.25 million.
So that's the original 1.25 million.
Yes, sir.
That's what's already been appropriated.
So there's money still there to already do it, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
We've got, still got a million, about 210,000.
So bypassing this, then what happened? Y'all just hadn't done the project, or I'm confused. What are we doing?
This is to approve us to go ahead and build the project. The project has never been actually approved by the commission. It was originally, I think back in February, was supposed to go to committee, but we never have had a committee meeting. And so now we're considering it under the full body now.
But the money is already in the budget.
The money is already, we've already got the money. It's already been appropriated.
So this is no new expenditure. This is not a new expense.
No, sir.
No.
That's what I was confused
about. Well, it hadn't been spent, though. Portions
of it have been spent for the study, but the money was allocated to do the project already.
Okay. And that's already in capital outlay?
Yes,
sir.
It's in our, it's already in our budget.
Okay. And y'all have to have our permission to just go do the project? Y'all can't just
yes,
do the
sir,
project?
Yes, sir. Y'all have to tell us to build
it. Oh, okay.
We can't just go out and build it. That's y'all's decision.
Oh, okay. No, I'm sorry. I thought if it was in the budget, y'all would do it.
No, not on this
not
type
on
of
things
deal.
Like this.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, in original, in the budgetary process, there was a project put into the budget. You know, then y'all approved the budget. Then we would go ahead and build something like that because y'all have looked at it during the budgeting process. But in this case, it's not like that.
So if it was done during the budget process, it takes, what, 7 votes to approve it?
Thank you.
So this here would take how many votes?
Seven
as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I guess we'll learn more about that as the budget process.
Yeah.
Okay, appreciate you. That's it. Thank you.
Commissioner Dominic.
Robert, hang on 1 second. So I'm a little bit confused because the agenda says confirm approval of Dawson Road drainage upgrade. Is this a drainage upgrade or extending the road?
This is extending the road.
Why does it say drainage upgrades?
Typo.
I don't know that, but it's.
And if it's doing extending the road, how far are we extending it and how much is that going to cost?
We're extending it approximately 3,000 feet to a cul-de-sac.
So it'll still remain straight down.
Yes, still remain a dead end road. It'll cost approximately $1.2 million.
I think the 80.
And how many houses are down there?
Yeah. At the end of the road.
How many? I mean, we're fixing an extension for
the extension. There's only one house down.
One house.
One house.
How does that person get out right now? I guess he has a road. Is that dirt road?
Yes,
it's not
a
parish
driveway. It's a gravel driveway.
So we're going to spend $1.2 million. Now, we did a study on the Rice Road, and it said, you know what it said, and it seemed like it wasn't feasible. Now, was this the most recent study that we got to?
Correct.
And from what I remember, it's saying it really wasn't feasible to do that either.
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay, and then the other thing I remember that we had voted to send this to committee, and it hasn't gone to committee. I don't know why. We're not getting a committee report. So
So, I mean, you know, I'm still thinking this needs to go to committee before we need to vote for it.
That's what we agreed to. I mean, you know, well, Ken, I mean, back in February, you voted to, we voted to send it to committee, is all I'm saying. We never.
It's April.
It never went, we voted in February to send this to the committee. It never went to committee. It's never been vetted. I mean, I can't support it until it comes out of the committee, especially when you have one, you're affecting only one house down there. I mean, from what I've got, we're spending $1.2 million that was already budgeted to run a road out there for one house. That their study says it's not feasible and it should have gone to committee for the committee to come back and say what we needed to do with it. So I can't support it like it is.
I have a point of clarification.
What is your point of clarification?
If it's saying road study or drainage, that's not going to get us in any legal quagmires or because I don't want the bloggers to come out and say, well, it says drainage, but it's actually a road extension.
It's always been a road extension.
Yeah. Okay, but it's saying drainage though.
Well, right. Oh.
I don't want the bloggers coming down here tripping. You know, I want to.
Isn't that a part of it?
All right.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I want to take us back a few years. And this is a few years when we said that the $2.5 million that would go to build the Rice-Dawson Road, the road that went all the way from Jefferson Page to Highway 80 Greenwood Road. And so part of the money for that was supposed to go through, that didn't go through, that got returned. Of that half of the half is this $1.25 million that was originally designated as the connector all the way from Jefferson Page all the way to Rice Road. And the reason for this money being allocated was because we couldn't get emergency services there fast enough. People couldn't get from one side of the road, one from Jefferson Page to Highway 80 fast enough. And we decided as a group to send it to do a study to see if it was a viable option. In the process of seeing if it was a viable option, a new fire station was built so that the emergency services was taken care of. And that the speed limit on this road that was proposed was low enough to where it was still faster to go all the way to the west to the road where the American Road Center is located, or all the way to the east where Pines Road is located. And so there was no time saving and there was no safety saving in any of this. And then somewhere in the process, all of a sudden, it morphed from having to have a connection for emergency services and having to have a connection for time saving into a cul-de-sac on private property. And I can tell you, I have a lot of friends in Caddo Parish that would love for us to spend $1.2 million to build a cul-de-sac on their property. Now, what I have passed out to every commissioner is the process for which we have roads in Caddo Parish, and that is that the developer builds the road to parish standards. And after the developer builds the roads to parish standards, then the parish is able to accept that road into ownership. That is not the process that we have taken here. This is, I salute, this is the best invention of a way to build a road for a person to increase the value of their property that I've ever seen in my entire life, but it's still what it is. This is building a private driveway for a private citizen with taxpayer money. And I can't vote for it, and I can't go with it. And we've been kicking this around for, I think, 3 years. I'll be voting no. Commissioner Atkins, you're next.
Thank you, President Lynn. It sounds to me like we're considering investing $1.25 million for an extension that goes to one home. An economic feasibility study has been conducted. It failed the economic feasibility study. there are always issues of access and safety that we all struggle with around the parish, but in my mind, I see no logical reason to build this extension, so I'll be voting no.
Commissioner Jackson, you're next on the list.
Oh, I already went.
You already, excuse me, and so did Commissioner, Representative Commissioner Johnson. You already spoke.
No,
you didn't, excuse me, Commissioner Johnson, you're next.
Okay. I think you're looking at this totally wrong. I mean, this is not going to be a private driveway.
Yeah,
this would be an extension of a road that would then be able to have additional houses placed on the road. If people who sat in these seats a long time ago would have said, well, we won't build no roads. We're not going to build roads. We're not going to extend roads. The parish will be bare. I wouldn't even be able to stay where I'm staying then, if that was the case. The statement you made about how the developer builds a road and then we adopt that road, well, in some cases, we actually build roads. We built one road that's called Northport Point right now that leads into Walmart. We built that. Developer didn't build it, we did. And that was a pulling legs and arms to get that done, and it had an economic value that would pay itself back within a year. But, you know, I just don't understand. I mean, if we don't ever build roads in the parish, how is the parish going to build residential? We talk about, you know, the population hasn't stagnant. So you got to be able to have roads going somewhere in order to put up houses. If you got a place in your district that you want to put a road in, bring it before us. You know, and then it's up to us to decide whether we want to do it or not. I mean, we can't do the roads inside the city limits of any municipalities. So you start doing roads in the parish. I mean, we're just sitting on the money. And that's one of the reasons why the taxpayers in the past tax proposal said, y'all just sitting on money. So why should we afford a tax bond for y'all to get more money out of us than y'all sitting on money? So if they see stuff that you're doing with the money, then therefore they're more apt to say when you bring a tax bond, well, they're using the money right, and therefore they'll vote in favor of the tax bond. And for y'all to sit here and say that this is the private driveway for an individual, since I do have a flow too, I want to make sure that our president and our parliamentarian keeps professional decorum in this meeting. And, you know, we also need to make sure that y'all read up on Robert Reed's order and make sure to read up on the charter, because, you know, what I was saying was true with Robert Reed's order, that you have to keep in discussion of the particular motion that's in hand, you have to keep in tune with what they're saying. I'm deviating from it because, you know, nobody wants to say that it's right or wrong. So I just hope that we will basically, when there's a point of order brought up, that somebody, if the parliamentarian doesn't address it, send it over to the attorney and let him address it, because it is Robert Rule's order. And to say that I was out of order, I'm just trying to make a point of order that was wrong to do. And, you know, you hit the gavel and all that, but I was right.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. And as President Privilege, I would like to say that it's very common for commissioners to begin with an event to get to their point and to pick and choose which commissioners get to do it and which commissioners don't get to do it is very difficult, but I have certainly witnessed several people being able to do it. Next on the list, Commissioner Jackson.
I call for the question.
Second.
The question has been called by Commissioner Jackson, seconded by Commissioner Dominick. Please vote.
Question, right?
Yes.
Okay. On the issue, please.
We're voting on the motion.
What are we voting on? Is what he wants.
You're voting on
16.
Confirm approval of Dawson Road drainage extension. Upgrades is what the agenda says.
Okay.
Just extension, Dawson Road.
And that fails. Next item, please.
Next, we move to new business. Confirm process and schedule for allocating non-governmental organization NGOs.
So move.
Move by Commissioner Jackson.
Well, I'll move. You know, it comes from a committee, so it doesn't need to be moved, right?
Excuse me. Move by Commissioner Atkins.
We still got to.
Second by Commissioner Jackson. Please vote. That passes. Next item.
Discuss information relative to trade relations between Caddo Parish and Cuba.
Move to direct the administration to send this to NLP.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Epperson. Second by Commissioner Bowman. You want to speak on that?
No, just send that to North Louisiana Economic Partnership.
I just want to make one comment. We need to realize that 60% of exports and things that come out of Louisiana come out of the state of Louisiana at any place in the country. And with Cuba being opened up, this is something that's very relevant and that has been talked about nationally. Thank you, sir.
All right. Please vote.
I've been at the sea.
I want to substitute this that we challenge
the dictator. Commissioner Miller to the cube.